It is August 4th, 1999. We are interviewing Daisy Bettina Miller. My name is Renee Firestone, R-E-N-E-E-F-I-R-E-S-T-O-N-E. We are in Studio City in California in the United States, and we will speak English. It is August 4th, 1999. I'm interviewing Daisy Miller. My name is Renee Firestone. We are in Studio City in California in the United States, and we will speak English. Good morning.
Good morning.
Would you please introduce yourself? Tell us where were you born and when?
I'm Daisy Miller, and I was born in Zagreb, Yugoslavia, in October 5, 1938.
How old does it make you now?
I'm now 60.
Tell us, what is your very first memory of your childhood?
I have flashes of memory, but one of the ones that stands out and comes to mind when you ask me that has to do with one of the attempts that my family made to escape Yugoslavia, to get out. And I guess I must have perhaps been maybe 2.5, 3 years old, almost three, not quite perhaps. And I remember being carried on somebody's shoulders, I believe it was my father, and we were walking through fields going uphill. And I also remember there was a rush, a hurry. We needed to move very quickly. And climbing up or coming up to this hill and being placed on the ground, and it was dark, it was night, and all of a sudden there were lights that shone in our faces and this monster standing behind me or beside me. And I was very frightened. And that monster turned out to be a German Shepherd, which was one of the guard dogs that the patrol that discovered us was accompanying. And I remember that vividly because the Shepherd was almost as tall or taller than I was, practically. I was a huge animal. And so to me, as a little child, this was a very frightening experience. And I remember the scene vividly and the fear, the rush of fear that came. And then that's all that I remember about that particular thing. But it was a frightening experience.
Do you remember who was with you? Who was around you at the time?
I know that my father was there, my mother, my sister, and I believe an aunt with two cousins. But I'm not certain, I'm 100% sure if they were there on this occasion. I know that we attempted to escape, and they were with us at times. But I believe in this particular case, my recollection is really clearly of my father, my mother, and sister, and these border patrol, I guess, or these soldiers with uniforms and this light, the flashlights shining, and this huge dog.
Now, what border was this?
You know, I have difficulty, but I think this is one of the areas that was still available to us to enter into Italy. And there were some parts of Yugoslavia that were protectorates or close to the Italian border that were still open and we could enter into. And I believe that that was it. So I am too young to know the facts, but I have that's what I have been told, and I think that that's what it was. We did not make it, of course. We were thrown back at that time.
When do you think you remember your mother? What age do you remember your mother the first time?
Consciously, my mother, that's a question, it's hard to. I sense her presence with me all the time, but I think, I must admit that I have more immediate recollection of father than mother for some strange reason, even though I'm sure that she was the one who nursed me and nurtured me. But father has more of an image for me as a young child.
At what age?
I suspect my first recollection was probably around 2 or 3 of actual memory. And I remember sitting on my mother's lap, and my mother actually, at some point, feeding me with a bottle. And I remember the sensation of this nourishment. It was milk with some added to it to give me some strength and nourishment through the nipple of this bottle. And I actually can almost feel the sucking sensation, you know, and the feeling of comfort that gave me and the security. So I do remember being on my mother's lap. I don't know what age that was, though.
Do you know where it was?
I think that this particular piece of it might already have been actually as we might have come into Italy. And that means that I would already have been older, probably 3, which is an unusual thing for a child that age, perhaps, to have a bottle with a nipple. But I think that I was, there was such concern about nourishing me in some way that there was an attempt made. And I guess I was smaller or weaker, perhaps thinner, and they were worried. And this is assumption on my part, that I got this as a sort of a something to give me a boost. And so I remember sitting on her lap somewhere outside in front of a house on a chair, and the comfort of that and that feeling and that sensation. It was very comforting. But I can almost taste it.
Did you ever talk to her about this?
I think I did, but she did not remember. And she, I think, tended not to want to talk too much about some of those experiences. And she, I think to her, this was made no impact. It was among many experiences as a mother. But to me, as the recipient of this nourishment, of course, it was very important.
You said that when you went to the border, you were sitting on your father's shoulders.
Right. I remember being carried for a time because there was a lot of walking to do. My family tried to escape, of course, from Yugoslavia many times. And there is some history, of course, that led up to that. But we tried to escape through various means. And I can get into that if you want to.
Do you know what year that was?
We ultimately entered Yugoslavia in 1941.
What year was that first attempt?
Probably in 39. Probably 39 or 40. Maybe 40. I am not clear on the dates. But I think it has to do with, first, my family, of course, my father was Austrian. And they came to Yugoslavia after the Anschluss in 1938. And my mother was pregnant with me.
Tell me your father's name and tell me a little bit about your father.
You know, that's a very hard question because there's not very little to tell. There's a lot to tell about my father. My father is someone who's very, very important to me. Always has been, and I think will continue to be so until the day I die. My father's name was Georg, or George, Georg Hirsch.
Spell it for us.
H-I-R-S-C-H. And he was someone who I think was a Renaissance man. He was someone who had talents from being an athlete as a young man. He was a runner and was athletic, to then being musically very talented. He played instruments, but also composed and wrote music and wrote plays. He also, in the later years, used some of his talents in artwork and painted and drew and painted. And that was in the later years of his life. So he was someone who was very very artistic and very well-read, spoke languages, and trained himself, basically.
What was his occupation?
He was worked with his father, who in Austria. This was prior to the war. My grandfather was in the lumber business, and my father worked for his father, and then went into his own business, in the lumber business, and actually was involved in in going to forests and purchasing trees and identifying trees to be then become the lumber. So he was in that area, in that field. I don't know that that was ever really something he loved to do, but that was what he did. I at first was not very successful, but then I think began to be more successful and did quite well. I understand he had a partner who, you know, so I think he did well, and this was just before the war, I guess.
Where was this?
This was in Graz. My father was born in Vienna, but then his family moved to Graz, which is in Austria. And there my family, my grandparents and my father lived, and with my mother. And then my sister, who was born in 1929.
When did they go to Yugoslavia?
My family escaped or left Austria in 1938, sometime in the summer of 1938, perhaps even earlier. I'm not sure exactly because I don't know. But my mother was pregnant with me. And this was 9 years after the first child. I understand that in between there were other pregnancies which did not go to full term. And so there was a nine-year difference. And so I was born a few months after they returned to Yugoslavia. And the reason they returned to Yugoslavia is to join family that was there on my mother's side. The hope was, of course, to escape. And in fact, my grandparents, my father's parents, also left for Yugoslavia before that, but were not happy there and actually returned to Austria, unfortunately, where ultimately they were, from where they were deported.
Tell us their names so we know.
My grandfather's name on my father's side was Oscar Hirsch, and my grandmother's name was Rosa Therese. She used both names, Hirsch.
Do you know her maiden name?
I'm not sure of my grandmother's, that grandmother's maiden name. Oh, perhaps, yes, I do. I actually do come to think of it. I believe it was Orvan. But I can spell that for you because that's part of that family. It's O-R-O-W-A-N.
What was their faith?
Jews. My family was Jewish. My family was part of the Jewish community. This is my grandparents. They were part of the Jewish community. I don't think that they were ever observant to the point that they were so, that they, for instance, had a kosher home or... They were assimilated, as I think many people in that part of the world were at that period of time. But they were part of the Jewish community and attended a temple for holidays, as far as I know. But to that extent.
What happened to them?
From my understanding is that they did go to Yugoslavia as well, were not happy there, and returned to Austria. And then with other relatives from Graz, went to Vienna, thinking that that would be of help. And of course, when after the Anschluss and the deportations began, they were in Vienna, and I believe in 1942 they were on a transport to Theresienstadt.
When your father came to Yugoslavia, what did he do?
He didn't work. There was really no work because at that time, basically, they joined family, my mother's family, which is a whole other background. My mother's family is from Yugoslavia, perhaps originally, I believe, but although I'm not certain, from Czechoslovakia. But my family, my mother's family, is a family that the last name is Koričan. And they lived in a very small town outside of Zagreb, where they had, that family had a business, a large business, which was foodstuffs and eggs, and on a large scale, like a grocery and foodstuffs, a large business, from what I understand. And they were well known in that town, and fairly well to do. And had a lovely large home and servants. And my grandmother and grandfather from my mother's side had, I believe it was seven children. My grandmother had also come from Austria originally and come to Yugoslavia, a rather interesting story. I'm not sure that I need to tell it here, but it was a story having to do with my grandmother, who was a beautiful woman in Vienna, whose father was quite well off, and she was engaged to be married. And unfortunately, he lost his money in a crash. And when that happened, of course, that was a big scandal. And her fiancé basically left her, and she was devastated. And so she applied for a position in the newspaper, which she answered for a governess in Yugoslavia, because she was too embarrassed to remain in Vienna. At that time, it was a very shameful thing to, of course, be left like that. And so she applied for this position as a governess, and she, in fact, went to Yugoslavia and was met at the train station by the oldest of the sons of this family that had many other children. And she came into that home and became the governess. And my grandmother, being a very beautiful woman and very willful, sort of began to become more and more her own person there, and ultimately married the very son who came to pick her up at the train station, and then she was the next generation. So it's a kind of a nice story.
Tell us their name.
Korichan. My grandmother's name in Vienna was Kohn, and my grandfather's name was Korichan.
And their first names?
Her name was Elsa, and his name was Alfred. So he was the older son, or one of the older sons, and was completely taken and smitten by her immediately. And I guess that, as it turned out, turned out to be all right.
What happened to them?
My grandfather unfortunately died before the war. He actually, I believe, served in the First World War, but he died of during an operation in Vienna, where he went to try to help himself for some illness that he had. And my grandmother returned to this town, which is Krapinska Toplice. I'm the spelling of it being difficult, but Krapinska Toplice, which is a resort town, sort of a spa in near Zagreb. My grandmother came back and then had to fend for herself with her seven children, and that was very difficult. But she did all right. She was a very tough, beautiful woman.
Let's get back to your mother.
Okay.
What was her name?
Lily. That's Lilly. Korichan. And she was a twin. She was a twin who, when she was born, was thought not to be able to survive because she was so small. And she did survive and made it through, but all of her life was sort of considered to be the smaller, weaker of all of the siblings. And she was a caretaker from the very beginning in her life, and always talked about the fact that she was the one who took care of many of the things around the home. She was a woman who all of her life really took the back seat, in a sense, but she was very strong and very tough.
Do you have memories of her before the war?
I have no real clear picture of it, except the sensation of being held, of being nurtured, as I said before, but no, I don't have any real recollection of her. Before the war. Before the war, being born in 1938, I basically was born into the war.
Did you discuss it with her ever?
The past?
The war years.
The war years. Yes, I ask questions. I always ask questions. I have always been very curious, and to this day, keep asking questions of those who are still alive, and unfortunately there aren't too many. But I have always been curious, and I have gotten some information, but interestingly enough, even though I ask the question, I find that I often don't remember. It's almost as though I ask, but yet I want to somehow block it out. I don't know why. I have general sense.
After you returned from the borders the first time, Do you remember or did you hear anything about what happened?
I just know from what has been told to me, because what I do remember is tension around me. Somehow I have, I guess even as an infant and as a small child, remember tension. You know, there's, it was never easy. And I do have a sense of lots of family being around. I mean, we were together with other family members during the various attempts at crossing borders. And there were also times when for instance, my family, after having been thrown back, was in a town called Cerkvenica on the beach, and the months spent basically together with other family members, and it was sort of a nice time together as a family. I have a sense of warmth, and that's really the memory that I have. I have some pictures of that period, so I have tried to put myself back there, but I really don't have any real recollection.
What was the first language you spoke?
I am aware, I speak German because German was spoken in the house. I suspect that I said a few words in Croatian because of the region where I was born, but I don't speak it, and I don't remember speaking Croatian. I remember Croatian around me, but I spoke German, and that was the first language that I remember. Beyond that, of course, after we then escaped, I picked up the language in Italy, which is where we were during the war.
Now, you told me you had an older sister.
Yes, I have an older
sister. What's her name?
Her name is Inge. It's at birth, actually, was Ingeborg, but her name is Inge. And she, as I said, is 9 years older than I.
What is her last name?
It was Hirsch, and it is now Servi.
When do you remember her first?
I remember her later. I remember her as a teenager. I remember her when we were already in Italy, after we finally made it into Italy from Yugoslavia. And I remember her as someone who was a kid, like 12, 13, 11, 12, 13 years old kind of thing. Around, but not any real intense time spent with her, because she was really into having fun with whoever she was around. My cousins were there, and so they excluded me because I was the little kid. I was always this little kid, and I have to say that I'm assuming that although everybody loved me very much, I was really a burden. And this is a judgment I'm making now, but the reality is, in those circumstances, to have a baby and then to have a small child to have to deal with under such difficult circumstances must have been very, very hard. So, but I never really felt it. I felt loved. I've always felt this sense of warmth and affection from everyone around me.
So when was the second crossing of the border?
There was one other memory that I have of an attempt to cross, and that was I don't know the circumstances, but I remember being in a car, in a large car at night, and from what I understand is that we were trying to get to the border by Ljubljana, which I guess is Slovenia, to get into Italy, to be able to cross. And my recollection is of being at night on this road and driving fast in this vehicle, which was a large vehicle, like a European, it was a taxi, I believe, a European taxi that had seats that faced to the back. You know how in the back seat you have seats forward and backwards in some of those old cars. And many family members in this car. And all of a sudden, I remember some major terrible thing happened. And there was a tremendous to-do. And I remember fear and horror all around me. But actually what had happened is that my mother, unfortunately, fell out of the car. The door opened and my mother fell out. I had been sitting on her lap until probably just a few moments before this happened. And a cousin of mine had asked her to let me sit on her lap. And so that happened just before my mother fell out. I mean, it was some miraculous thing that I did not fall out with her. She was somehow, strangely enough, able to be okay, and we, but that is a moment that I remember, and it may not sound like much, but it was a very powerful moment because my mother was hurt in some way, and as a child, that's something you really react to, was fear. So that's a recollection. I remember also on another, on this attempt, whether it was this one, or I believe it was, where we were, I had to sleep on benches, and we were caught, actually, or asked, we were caught by the local gendarmes police and kept there and then sent back again. So there were several attempts, and even though other family members somehow got through with false papers, we never quite could make it. And it took basically, you know, over 2 years, as far as I know, to finally get through. We were actually interned in Yugoslavia. So we had papers and we could not, you know, that said we were Jews and we could not leave.
You were interned where?
I am not sure exactly of the location. I think it may have been something called Samobor.
We are going to change tapes now, okay, and then we'll continue.
Thank you.
Yugoslavia, and you were interned in Yugoslavia. Was it a camp? Was it a ghetto?
From what I understand, and I want to clearly say that these are not things that I remember, these are things that were told me, you know, so I hope that I am as accurate as I can be in this, and that needs to be understood. But I understand that we were interned, and there was a time when we were in an area where there were others who were interned with us, and it was very difficult. Although I believe it was at this time that my father even attempted, I think, to, in writing music, to actually maintain some kind of, not normalcy, because that's impossible, but something, you know, he tried to make some life, and I think he wrote some music, and I think he there was maybe some a play or something that was staged, perhaps. And this is just a vague recollection of what has been told me. But so there was an attempt to try to make life happen, even though everyone was very frightened and fearful of being taken. And there was really no sense of, I guess, at that point as to where ultimately everyone was going to end up, because who knew at that point what was in store. But I know that my father was very aware and very conscious, thank goodness, of the need to get out, to get away, because he knew that there was something terrible coming.
What did you hear later about this camp?
I don't think it was a camp. I think it was an area where we were not allowed to leave from. That there were other families there, as I said, that there was a sense, I think money was scarce. Some family that was still living in outside of this area of sisters of my mother who had other papers, I think helped with perhaps food and even money, I think, to try to help us in some way. The family was very close and tried to help each other, and I think that was immensely helpful, but we seem to always have this bad luck. My father, because he was Austrian and my mother Yugoslavian, somehow there was a bad mixture, and so there was a real difficult, we had a real difficult time in terms of getting out.
Did you hear who guarded actually this place?
I I don't know, but they're guarded by, I suspect, the local police, and perhaps at that point by the Ustashis. But I don't know. It was just at this point, this was still. I think that I don't know. I cannot tell you. I'm sorry. I don't want to misspeak here.
What did you learn later about the Ustashis? Who were they?
I have to be honest with you. I have a real resistance to wanting to know too much about that time, and I am not particularly proud of that. I find myself not wanting to read about it, but I know that the Ustashis were Croatians who were very much welcoming, of course, to the Nazi regimes, and were very closely tied with them. As a matter of fact, went above and beyond what they needed to do or were to do in that period of time. The Ustashis, and these are the local Croatians, who were very much anxious to rid that country of any Jews and others, undesirables who were there. But they were, from what I understand, very, very cruel and very, very even worse, in a sense, at times, than the very government that they were representing there.
What did you hear later about the fact that you tried to escape to Italy? Of all places,
Italy was a border country, and that country was still open to people coming, and it allowed still entry, which was obvious place to go, even though that was a fascist country. It was clearly under Mussolini was a fascist country, and there had been laws instituted in Italy which were very restrictive to the Jews. Jews were not allowed to go to school, Jews were not allowed to get an education, Jews were not allowed in many, many ways. Yet the Italians, even though these laws were in place, were very lenient and still very willing to allow people in. And we, knowing that, of course, that was the natural place. We certainly would not go to Austria. We certainly would not go to any country. So Italy was the natural place for us to want to, the closest, nearest, and best place for us to escape. And I know many people, not many, not enough, who took that route. And we ultimately made it.
When was that?
In 1941. And that was, I believe, sometime in the fall of 1941.
Do you recall?
Or the spring of 41. I don't know the dates exactly, but I don't recall, but I do recall after having gotten there. I don't remember the process. Actually, what happened is that my aunt, my mother's twin sister, and her husband and family were already there. And she, who was a very strong woman and someone who would not give up, very relentless, very wonderful woman, sold jewelry, did anything to get us false papers, and we finally were able to then get across, and we crossed into Italy from Yugoslavia, and were met by my uncle, who then took us to Montecatini, which was a small city outside of Florence, where it was sort of a holding place, and there we were again interned, this time by the Italian government. And there were others like us who had come from Yugoslavia and other places who were interned in this little city, Montecatini. Montecatini is a spa city known for its curative waters and was considered, sort of a vacation place. And it was a lovely little city, still is. And there we lived with family together.
When you say interned, what does that mean?
Interned meant that we had to report regularly to the local authorities, that we had special documents which said we were Jews, that we were not, to leave that area. We were not allowed to just freely come and go, that we had to report in all the time. And when, in fact, then we were, there were changes, we were then told where to go next. We were not free, but we had freedom of that little city. We were not imprisoned.
Was there a difference between being Jews and being foreigners?
I don't know. To the Italians? I don't know. I don't think so. although there were these laws, of course, in place in Italy. But I think we were considered part of this influx of people coming from other places, escaping. So I think we got caught up in that. But it was clear that we were Jews. By the way, speaking of Jews, you know, and being marked, I know that my family wore the star in Yugoslavia. They had to wear the star, and my sister has told me that she remembers pushing me in my stroller, and that my stroller had, there was a star on my stroller as a baby, a Jewish star.
What year?
The yellow star.
This?
Well, it probably was sometimes in 1938 or so. 39 probably by this time, after 39 maybe.
Do you know when your family left Montecatini?
Montecatini?
Catini.
We left in, I believe, in 1942, in the summer. This was a town that, of course, had a lot of visitors because it was a vacation spot. So the local authorities did not want all of these immigrants taking up all this housing and being there. So basically, we were told that we had to go elsewhere. And there was a little town in the mountains called Femina Morta, where we were then lived for the next 3 months with, again, others. And we lived in a hotel, actually. It was a resort hotel. And we're there for, I believe, 3 months until we were again allowed to move to another place because we were not, you know, we had to do it according to or whatever. And I do have memories of that place as well, of being there with my father, because it was a sort of a nice spot. It was a pretty, everywhere we were, I think at this point, we tried to make the best of it, you know. I mean, to the little, and I, as a child, because I was not in on the planning of what was going to come next, my recollections are of the times that I had there. So I remember, for instance, being in a garden there, and there were peas growing and vegetables growing, and my father pointing out to me all the different vegetables. And at this point, I guess I was about 4. And I remember that. And so, you know, my memory of it is sort of having these little vignettes of moments. And I was not, as I said, part of the planning. So that was, in a sense, as a child, life was easier that way.
Did you later discuss with your parents or with your sister how did the Italians behave during this period of time? How did they behave towards you?
From what I have gotten, and my sense of it, is that the Italians did what they had to do, but they did it reluctantly, and they did it kindly, for the most part. Perhaps there were some individuals who took their roles as officials, you know, very seriously. But for the most part, these were people who could identify with the human aspects of what was going on. And I have to say that in my entire experience in Italy, and from what I've been told from others who were Italians, who were that was really the experience. The Italians were quite different from any other of the people surrounding them.
Did your parents later talk to you about the Catholic Church in Italy?
The Catholic Church? No, this is something that I basically discovered later as I was growing up in Italy.
What did you discover?
That I was living in a country that was Catholic, that this was another religion, and I was very curious about its stories, the things, you know, that you do in a mass, and the smells and the sounds and the of going to church and the Latin, you know, I was into the ritual of it. I did not know at that point of the political, you know, some of the issues that I know have been, of course, brought to the surface, dealing with how the church was not necessarily cooperative and certainly helpful to us at the time on a more official basis. But my experience, I did not have any negative experience. And there was never a question of anti-Semitism. I really never sensed, and there really wasn't, in Italy, there was not a sense of anti-Semitic feeling. It was political. It was not an anti-Semitic issue. And that is big. That's a big thing to say when in 1940s when the war was raging.
Well, after you grew up and you discussed these times in Italy, was there any discussion about the Pope?
Not really. Not really. Because I think everyone at that point was so involved with making a life and dealing with life and then going on. I don't remember being part of any real discussion about the church itself. No, I do not. And if I know of anything, it came later, much later in life when I was made aware and I thought of it and learned more about it, its role in the Jews in Europe.
So again, you left Montecatini what year?
I guess this was in 1942. Yes.
And went
to this little town, this little resort up in the mountains. And from there, again, when that hotel had to be occupied by visitors, we were sent off or told to find another place. And there were certain areas where we could go. And so my father and my uncle and I believe my aunt made their way and found this little town in the hillsides outside of Florence. And the name of it is Quarrata. Where we then ultimately ended up spending the war, or that piece of the war.
When did you get to Quarrata?
To Quarrata we got in 1942. And in Quarrata, my father and my aunt and uncle befriended, somehow found, I guess is in some way discovered, a well-to-do, quite well-to-do landowner who basically owned much of what was in that town. He was a furniture manufacturer. And he was somehow taken by our story. And he was willing to help us. And he saved our life. He basically saw to it, he had a villa that he owned on the side of the hill in this little town. And this house, it's a villa. We call it a villa. Please don't think that it is, you know, some luxurious place. But it was a large house, a well-built, strong house on the side of this hill. And we gathered there. The family then gathered there. We then lived in this villa, in this house, until... Then it was clear that the Germans, once Italy and Germany, of course, broke their alliance and the Germans came into Italy, we then had to find other ways to hide.
Do you remember the name of the family?
His last name.
That owned the villa.
Yes, I know the last name, and it's Lenzi.
Spelling?
L-E-N-Z-I. He was willing to help us. Now, from what I understand, and this is something I was told later, that we have no money, so we could not really pay for anything. But my aunt gave jewelry, from what I understand, to be as sort of a, pawned in a sense. He would keep it, and if we never made it, it was his. And, you know, and that was how I think. But he did not do it for that. I really believe the man was quite astounding in that he was willing to help us. And not only that, but he also then helped us later.
The family, the Italian family, the Italian family, how many were there?
Of the Lenzi, you mean?
Yes.
I don't know. It was the only person that I know of is he. He was not directly involved with us. We did not really see him. They met him originally, but he basically had others then do the work for him. And that was, you know, he enlisted other people to help find places for us and so on. People who worked for him, people who had small farms in the hills and mountains where he knew of that he could get help from. So he basically was not hands-on directly involved, but he was instrumental in getting this movement going so that we could be saved.
Did you ever make contact with him after
he died after the war? I did not make contact directly, although I've gone back and I, you know, there are places in that town that still, I think, bear some of his name, but not. There was contact made from my family, but I am not, unfortunately, aware enough of the specifics. I do have recollection, though, of the people who then ultimately were, of course, responsible for saving our life directly.
So. Who were they and where?
Well, first, if you don't mind, I'd like to just go a little bit in the sequence of this. We moved into this villa, and while we were there, we basically lived fairly openly. We did have to report to the authorities because, again, we were interned there. We could not leave that area. And we had a connection with the local official. In Italian, it's Marsciallo, I guess, is the name of the, it's like the marshal of that town. And he was someone who was willing to help us as well. And so he helped by sort of, you know, slipping things through. And that's what I mean about, I think the Italians were much more willing to bend the rules and be helpful. So we lived in this villa, and I remember that place very vividly, even though I was four when I got there, and I have very vivid recollections of this setting. I remember the rooms so clearly that when I have gone back since, I've been able to point out exactly where I slept, where so-and-so slept, where so-and-so slept. I know exactly that place, and I have a very good feeling about it. There, I made friends with the farm kids next door or nearby, and I was a little kid. I really basically lived like a little kid.
How long?
I guess the better part of a year. We lived in that villa so it was a very intense, meaningful time, because it was a time when we basically initially felt, again, a sense of relief that we had made it this far and now we were going to be okay, not knowing again what was coming.
Do you know if your sister went to school?
No, my sister and cousins, who were of her age, did not. We were in this circumstance with my mother's twin sister, her husband, their two daughters, my grandmother.
Which grandmother is that?
My mother's mother. We also then were joined by an aunt and her two sons. Her husband, my mother's brother, had been deported to a camp. I guess it was to Jasenovac, I think, in Yugoslavia. And he was ultimately killed there, although we did not know that until later. So this aunt with her two young children came and joined us as well. So we were 12 altogether, which was quite astounding considering the circumstances that we found each other and were able to be together. This was in this villa. And I have recollections of playing with my cousin and a fairly, you know, fairly easy, except as things got worse politically, and then we had a shortwave radio, which of course it was not allowed really, but there was a radio that I remember where I remember the family sitting by this radio at night listening to the BBC and the sound of the wave, you know, the shortwave going in and out, that sound I still remember. And watching my family and being part of the scene where everyone was very scared, very nervous, very worried. I didn't fully understand, but I knew that something terrible, of course, was happening. And that was that the Germans, of course, now Italy and Germany had split. And so we would get reports, I think. And my father had made arrangement with the local official, this Marsciallo, that if and when the Germans would come into this area, that he would please notify us so that we could get out.
Do you remember how you communicated with the Italian children?
I guess I picked up quite a bit of Italian by that point. I had now been in Montecatini as well as in this other place, so my Italian, my language came, and I spoke Italian as a four-year-old would. And I played with these children and talked to them like a kid, you know. I don't think there was a distinction. I never had a sense of anything. And I remember them. These were farmers' children, and I remember playing all kinds of games with them. And it was fairly normal seeming, you know, considering the circumstances.
Do you recollect what kind of games you played?
I have one that I remember. You know, in Italy, there was no, as I know in many parts of Europe, of course, there was no heating, central heating, so it was cold in the winter, very cold. And there is, there used to be in the countryside, they had a contraption which was sort of like a domed, framed, a half dome. It's hard to explain. It's sort of a domed, framed piece of wood framed or bamboo framed plywood, thin plywood framed contraption. And inside was empty. And in it, there was like a hook. And there you hung a brazier. A brazier which was made out of terracotta, which is a sort of a basket with a handle made out of terracotta, if you can picture that. And in it, they would put hot coals. Now, you hung that, and then you would put it in your bed. And you would cover this, and that's what this round contraption was for, so that it would not get to the fire, so the blankets were over it. And that's how you warmed your bed, so that at night you could go in there and have a warm bed. I remember that very clearly. Plus, we would sit, and the women particularly would sit with these braziers in their laps with these hot coals, and you would keep your hands over them because you would get frostbite. You know, it was that cold. And we had layers and layers of things on because it was really cold. And so I remember one game, I took this thing, not the brazier, but this contraption, and I put it around me, and I put a doll inside. And I remember vividly standing on this balcony and saying, "Look, I'm going to have a baby." Now, how I knew at 4 or 4 and a half by this point that is, I don't know how I learned it, but I must have seen someone who was pregnant, and someone said, "There's a baby inside." And I remember having this thing and pretending there was this baby inside. And I remember that scene because I remember the adults laughing very hard, and I guess I embarrassed them maybe by it. I don't know. But so that's one thing that I remember. And the other thing I remember is that I tended to be sort of a take charge person, like I am now. And that is that I always sort of led these kids, and they followed me. So whatever games we played pretended to have a house and cooking and whatever things I did, I was sort of the leader of this. And that's another thing that comes to mind when I think of those games.
Do you remember any interactions with your sister?
Not really, because my sister at this point was, I guess, in her teens, and she was more interested in, she and my cousins, who were close in age, same age just about, always dressed alike. They were like sisters, the three of them, and they basically didn't want to have much to do with me because I was just this little kid. And so they had their own world, and there were boys in the area, and so there was, I think, you know, an interest. They would go bicycling, and they would go do things. I was excluded. I was not part of it.
Do you remember this, or you just heard?
No, I remember this. No, I remember this, and I remember sort of being on the outside of that circle. But I did have a cousin who was about a year and a half older than I, a boy, who was near in age to me, and so I remember much about him. And he and I spent time playing outside and pretend games and those kinds of things. So him I remember.
Did you have a sense of relationship, that these were relatives, that they belonged to you?
Yes.
And the difference between the outside?
Yes. This family of mine was very close and very, very demonstrative. So I was fortunate in that I was, particularly with my father and my mother, in that I got a lot of attention from them, certainly, and physical contact, my father particularly. And I have sense of family. I was a little afraid of my uncle, who was rather stern. And for instance, we would sit and eat, and there was a bowl of fruit, and after every meal, we could have some fruit, but we were only allowed to have a little bit of one or two walnuts or one or two pieces of orange, you know, because there wasn't that much. So there was all this rationing, and I remember resenting the fact, you know, that he would only give me a little bit. So silly things, you know, but as a child, it made an impression on me. But otherwise, my recollection of this period is of togetherness, a family connection. The other thing I remember very clearly is that I would be put to sleep at night, and I remember exactly where I slept, in this little iron bed with like a crib-like thing, even though I was four, a bed with sides up on it. And I would not want to go to sleep at night. I always remember wanting to stay up as late as possible because I wanted to be part of the scene. I wanted to hear. I wanted to know everything, just like I still do. And I was always excluded because I was a kid. I had to go to bed early. But I heard them downstairs talking and planning and discussing. I didn't know what. But I wanted to hear, so I would stand there and listen, and then I'd finally start screaming and crying. And then my mother had to come, and my mother would sit next to me, and she would stroke me, and I would play with her a hand and whatever, and then I would fall asleep. And that was like a routine almost every night. But I resented the fact that I could not be part of that. I always wanted to be included, and always felt excluded.
Talk about this physical feeling that you have about your father, with your father and with your mother.
My father was a very affectionate man, very warm, and I have great recollections of holding his hand, sitting on his lap, being hugged, being held, being talked to, and just lots of affection, tremendous amount of affection and love. And I, you know, this continued into later on, which was very important, of course.
And your mother?
And my mother as well, but my mother was very busy with household things. My mother had to do the household, take care of feeding all of these people and cooking with my aunt. And so she was often busy, and I spent more time, it seems, at least my memory of it is with him. He made an impact.
We will change tapes again. In Quarata, and you were telling me a little story about the nipple that you...
That actually, I'm not sure if it was there or earlier, but I have a recollection, and this may have been actually earlier in my life, in still in Yugoslavia, where I had a pacifier. And I guess it was very comforting to me. And they tried to convince me, I guess at this point I was three, they tried to convince me to be rid of it because it was really a pain in the neck, I'm sure, for them. But also, it was just, I was too old. And so they asked me to throw it away, and I would not. But then on one of our attempts, this is going back in history now, we came in, we were in the countryside somewhere, and there was we stopped at the side of the road, and there was a goat on another side of a fence. And I remember this field. I remember the scene vividly, although my sister who was there claims that did not happen, but I think that that's one of the issues, of course, that as a child these things make an impact where it would not have made an impact on her. But I remember the scene clearly and seeing this animal on the other side of this fence and taking, and they told me to give him the nipple, this pacifier, to give it to the goat. He probably needed more than I did. I'm sure that's what they said, or something like it. And somehow, I just took it and threw it over the fence. And I feel that sensation almost still to this day, giving this up. It was like a loss of something very important. It's as though, consciously, I'm sure this was not happening at the time. It's only in retrospect. But somehow that pacifier, I think, represents something very powerful, and that was a sense of security. It's almost as though throwing that away meant I'm on my own. I'm now entering into a different stage. Now, of course, this is in retrospect, please keep in mind. But I have a feeling that that is so. That was a powerful moment for me as a child, and I'm very conscious of that. And I have resisted adult, my sister, who, you know, claimed that it didn't happen, because I know that happened.
So we are still in Kwarata. Tell us where you went from here, when.
So as the news came, of course, that the Germans were now nearing our area, the local authority, whom my father had asked to notify us when that was so, in fact, Kay gave the word. My father, being very forward-thinking, I am so grateful to him, as we all are, he made arrangements with a farmer up the hill, up the mountain, through again, I believe this was again through this Mr. Lenzi, found this person who was willing to take us in. We didn't know for how long, but he was willing to take us in case of a quick getaway. And so my father had sent blankets and that he had stored and potatoes, I think, and food stuff, some of it, up to this place so that we would have something there for him, for us. And sure enough, the day came when the word came that they were coming. We had to get out. So we left with basically the clothes on our backs. We took nothing much. I mean, just clothes, whatever we could wear, basically, and made our way up to this place, which is off a very rugged road on this hillside, and got there, and that's where we spent our first night in hiding, true hiding. There was a terrible incident that occurred, unfortunately, on that night. I remember the scene, and I remember it. I can almost visualize it as I'm sitting here. We were in the kitchen area, the front room of the house. You walk into these old farmhouses in Italy. These were centuries old houses. And they're basically a room you walk into, which was usually the kitchen. Sometimes to another part, right, to the right or left of it, there was another room which was more of a dining room, guest type of living room, but very primitive with the table and chairs. And then there were stairs that would go up to the bedrooms. That was basically the house. In most of these homes, that's how it was. And in the back sometimes, there were actually animals kept. In the back of the kitchen area, there was like a stalls for... So it was all often very self-contained, very primitive. No running water, no electricity, and in this case, no indoor place to use as a bathroom. So at one point, we were all lying on the floor in this kitchen, trying to sleep. By this time, there were 12 of us. And my mother had to go to the bathroom. And I think the reason why we were in the kitchen on the floor is because I think, from vague recollection, that the farmer's, one of his children, had some maybe measles or something that was a communicable disease, and it was just bad luck, and we could not go upstairs in any way, in any room. So we were in this kitchen area, and my mother had to go to the bathroom, and so she had to go outside to the outhouse, wherever that was, and asked my father to go with her. And so they went outside. And the next thing I remember was the door opening up, and my mother walking in with my father, and there's blood streaming from her face, just covered with blood, and there's a piece of skin basically hanging over her eyes. You know, I remember this red blood. So, of course, we were all, there was screaming, what's going on? What had happened, there was a ditch that had been dug, and no one had alerted them to that, and she fell. And so, what do we do now? We cannot get a doctor. We're on top of this hill, mountain. What do we do? So, I don't know what they found to put something over her, but it was bleeding. My mother, unfortunately, on top of everything else, was a bleeder. So they finally, the decision was made that they had to get her to the town in some way. And the farmer offered to take them down on his in his cart, in his carriage. It was a buggy. It was actually not a, it was a cart, a wooden cart with horse-drawn cart. I don't know if it was a mule or a horse even. I don't think he had a horse. I think we were just like mules or something. And so the decision was that my father and my sister and my mother and this farmer would go down the mountain. And of course there was tremendous fear that they would be caught in some way, especially my father who, you know, the instruction was that my sister was to do the talking because she spoke some Italian. And although my father spoke Italian, I guess he had an accent, and that was not a good idea. And the papers we didn't have other than the papers we had. So this was, now by this time it was middle of the night, and they actually went down this treacherous stone dirt road winding down this mountain to the town and went to the doctor's house. There was a doctor in this town, and they went to the doctor's house, and they came to him. He was, of course, he was asleep, and they woke him up, and they told him that she had fallen and hurt herself. And so at first he was reluctant to help them, but he did. He bandaged her up and basically told her to, I don't know, there was no ice, there was nothing to do, you know. So he bandaged her up, and they came back up to the mountain. And meantime, I was left with my aunts, and I remember one of my aunts, the mother of those two boys, was very kind to me and sort of took me and comforted me. And I think I might have slept. They came back, and unfortunately, a few hours later, my mother hemorrhaged. And the reason we knew that, because suddenly her bandages were covered in blood. Again, my recollection is of seeing this blood. Blood was everywhere. And so the decision was made that they had to go back. And again, they had to go down. But this time, my father stayed behind because it was too dangerous for him to go. And so my sister went with this man and my mother. And they went down, and they went to the doctor, and the doctor would not see them. It was too dangerous. He knew that we were foreigners. We were not Jews to him necessarily, but we were the Slavi, I guess. We were foreigners. We were there. He knew that we were not to be there. And he did not want to help again. So my sister, who drove to the home of this man, Lenzi, and actually outside of his window called him, pounded on the door. He finally came, and she explained what had happened. And somehow, I don't know how now, they got her, whether he or someone drove her with my sister, to a hospital in another town in this valley. And so they were gone, and the farmer came back and told us what had happened. And now my mother and sister were no longer part of this group. Back to us, the next day we had to leave this house. The man who took us in was feeling too uncomfortable, and besides here he had all these people, there was just no way to keep us. And so again, we had help, and a place was found for us where we were the next night taken. And this was a place which was over valleys and hills and dirt roads, walked at night, and I remember being carried. And I don't remember exactly by whom, probably by my father. And we walked and got to this place where this place was a hovel. Again, it was in the hills, in the mountains. It was a stone structure among other stone houses where this particular building consisted of two spaces, rooms. It was a room downstairs and a ladder to a room upstairs. And I think there was a place that looked like a sink, but of course there was no running water or any lighting or anything like that. And that's where we then stayed. And I think we were there for several weeks. Meantime, my mother was not there. We had no word. We really did not know what was going on there. And that's when the bombardments started. The valley was actually bombed. Now, I'm assuming that these were the Allies, I guess, bombing this area. And the Germans were, of course, all over. And we watched these bombings of this valley below, knowing that my mother was in a hospital down there. And we really had no sense of what was going on. And, you know, I remember everybody around me being so scared and yet trying to comfort me, but my mother wasn't there and I was scared. But it was frightening. It was awful. I remember that. I also remember people coming to young men from the area who this landowner had asked to help us, coming in with newspapers which talked about what was going on. So that's how we kept aware of what was happening in the area. And it became clear that we could no longer stay in this, because we were really, there was a yard, a little hillside, we were outside, you know, we could be outside, but there were people around, they knew we were there, and it was too dangerous. We could be denounced anytime and carted off. So my father and my uncle, because they were looking for men, particularly the Germans were looking for labor to help them, and so they were rounding up men in the area. Never mind that we were foreigners; any men they were looking for. So even the Italian men were in danger in a sense, and so my father had to leave, and my uncle left, and they each found they were taken to farmers, who then took them in, and they lived in a room, each in their own house with their own little room.
Let's go back for a moment. This little house that you described, where was that?
In the hillsides outside, above this town, Quarrata. And we called it the buco. Buco is, in Italian, means hole. That's what it was, basically. And we always refer to it as the buco.
Who did this belong to?
I don't know. It was sort of an abandoned, but it may have belonged to this guy, a man, Lenzi. I don't know. It may have, because he was a landowner and he owned properties all over the place with many abandoned old houses or houses that had tenant farmers in them, you know. They worked, many of these people worked, they didn't own the houses they lived in or the land they lived in, but they worked the land and were allowed to keep some of the, you know, this happened all over Europe, and they would then be tenant farmers, I guess.
Do you remember seeing any German soldiers?
Not at that point, no. No, this was all, they were out there, but we did not, at this point, we were not confronted with them at this point.
When the bombing started, how old were you?
At this point, I guess I was, so this was in, I don't know, 4.5, 5 years old, probably 5.
What did you understand that noise was?
I knew there were bombs. I was told they're bombing. And what I remember was that the troops on the ground would drop flares so that it would light up the valley. And so it was lit. You could actually see, and so that the bombs could find, because in those days they didn't have night infrared kind of technology that they have now. And so they would light up with flares and then the bombs would drop. And so it was an incredible scene. You would see these huge lights, and then the sound after the bomb would hit, we would hear ba-boom, ba-boom, you know, the sound. So I remember that sound clearly in my head.
What did you think a bomb was?
Well, I know it was something very destructive. I knew that it was something very scary and that it would hurt people. As a kid, you know, I knew that because this is what everybody was so scared, and that it could destroy things and that it could kill people. And
was the word war
used? Yes, all the time. War was something that I...
What did you think war was?
Let me put myself back there. War was a time where bad people were after good people and they were out to hurt them. It was frightening, and it had to do with mean people, bad people, looking to destroy you, to get rid of you. That was a message. I mean, I knew that, and the danger of that, so we had to protect ourselves. That was, I think, now I don't know, please remember that this is coming from a 60-year-old thinking back, but I'm really trying to remember what that, you know, I knew I was not innocent enough. There was some loss of innocence at that point. I do remember the fear that was permeating my whole atmosphere everywhere I was, and it was war.
So when your father went to this buco?
The buco, we were all, except for my mother and sister, we were together there. He then went off, and I remained with the rest of the family. And we slept on the floor in this room upstairs, the second room that you got through on a ladder. We all slept on the floor on blankets. There was no furniture, no bedding, nothing. And we all slept lined up, 12. We just happened to fit just right in the space. And for some reason, I don't know who started it and how, maybe it was my father, I don't know initially, but every night before going to sleep, and I remember this in the dark, in English, somebody would say, "Good night, everybody." And we would respond, "Good night." I don't know why. I don't know if my father started that, but that's something that I remember. And I suspect my sister or someone knows. I don't. But it was, "Good night, everybody." It was like a little ritual.
Do you know who said it?
It might have been my father.
Do you remember him not saying it when he wasn't there?
No, I just remember hearing that at night. And I don't know if we continued it after he left or not. I don't know, but I remember that clearly. You know, I guess you hang on to everything you have at a time like that when you're surrounded with so much uncertainty and fear, that you hang on to anything that will make you hang, you know, something.
Tell us, how did you get reunited with your parents and your sister?
My mother made it through and came back. She actually came back. I don't remember the day she came back. I don't remember the scene. Maybe, I don't know why, but I know that it was great joy that she had made it. She had this huge scar across the forehead. And to the day she died, she had this huge scar. And she came back, and we then, almost immediately, I believe, had to go further into hiding because this was too dangerous to be living so openly with people around. And so we then joined my father, and my aunt and cousins went, and I believe my grandmother, although I'm not sure where she was. I believe she was with my aunt and uncle, went to where he was. So, and my other aunt with her two boys went into a third place. So there were three houses with three families who were actually willing to take us in. And that was also at the behest of the urging of this man who had made these arrangements with these different people. And these were all, I think, probably people that worked in some way under him, who were then, he was like the owner, and I guess there was some authority there. But I guess they could have refused. I don't know. But they took us in.
What was his name again?
Lency. And they took us in. And then I remember, of course, the next phase, which was in this house, in this farm. And this
Where was this?
Was also on the hillside outside of this town, Quarata. These are all little hamlets or little clusters of houses, in some cases some close by, in some cases some distant. We ended up in one that was really had no immediate neighbors. It was a house that was on a hill overlooking this wonderful valley. You know, Tuscan hills are beautiful, and the scenery was gorgeous, so there was some strange thing about being in this lovely land and yet being so fearful. So we were in this house, which was probably built centuries ago. And again, the house consisted of a big room and downstairs, a kitchen with a large fireplace where they baked bread and they cooked. There was actually a big black cauldron hanging from the inside of the fireplace on a chain where they cooked their meals, and they had fire on the sides that they fanned so that they would cook.
Who were they?
They were a family that was comprised of the leader of the family, his brothers, their wives. There were two brothers and their wives, and then their children. So it was a large family.
Do you remember names?
Yes. The leader of the family, his name was Giuseppe Santi. I think it was Santi. Although I think maybe the Santi was the name of the house. Now I'm confused. I'm not so sure. But the last name of the family, his family, was also Guidotti. Guidotti, and there were brothers, and in some cases those brothers married sisters. So there were there was a closeness among them as well, and some of their children. There was a boy of about 10 or so, 12, who was the son of this leader. And then the two other families that lived in this house had small children, little girls. One family had two little girls, and then the other had children born soon, during this period and soon after. These were people who took us in, and knowing full well, I think, that this was terribly dangerous, but they took us in and saved our lives.
Did they get paid?
No, I am not aware that they were paid. I don't believe that there was any payment. I don't know how that was arranged, to be honest with you. How this Lency and these people, I don't know. And the shame of it all is that I can't find out now.
Why?
Because there's no one is alive. There's only one person alive who I can talk about a bit later. But her memory, I think, is also somewhat changed or affected by time. So I cannot speak to that, but I can tell you that there was no money exchange. We had no money. There was nothing for us to give them. So they took us in, and we then lived in this room. We basically had a room in this house upstairs where the windows were mostly closed. The shutters outside were often closed during the daytime, or if they were open, we were not allowed to be at the window because no one should see us. And at night, of course, the shutters, everything had to be closed, so there should be no light, because this was a room that supposedly was an empty room. You know, if there were any neighbors or people around who knew the family, they knew that they were not supposed to have anyone in that room. So there was always this issue about staying away from the windows. The room consisted of a bed, a double bed, of iron footboard and headboard. I believe this mattress was straw or maybe horsehair or some really rough material. My sister, I believe, slept on some kind of a mattress-like blankets on the floor, and I slept, as I remember it, on something called a baule. A baule is like a hope chest. In the old days, there were these chests, and I slept on top of it with a blanket or something. And there was a little table and a couple of chairs and a dresser. That was the room, and it was small, but basically that was it.
Do you remember this?
Yes, vividly. I can tell you what it smelled like, almost what it felt like. The floor was brick, the walls were whitewashed, and the furniture was really very basic wood. My father, before we came, had spent time in that room, and he would mark the days on the wall with a pencil. He would make a mark. And he also, to keep himself occupied, started drawing on the wall the images of the farmers. So he drew them on the wall. When we came, there were these things on the wall. And so I remember being in this room and just not being allowed to make any noise, to be very quiet, and to just be very not. Now, how, you know, when I think back, it's amazing to think how to keep a five-year-old child from, you know, in such a limited space, how to keep this child occupied and quiet enough. I don't know. It's amazing. I remember having toothaches. I remember crying, having pain, and there was nothing much to be done for me. The farmers fed us. Of course, the food was very basic, you know, just vegetables, potatoes. There was really no meat, no eggs, no milk available. Every morning they would come in, the woman would come upstairs with a large slices of bread with oil and on them, and something called, you know, like a tea-like, I guess, tea. Somehow they got either tea or some kind of drink. And that was always a treat in the morning to get that. At night, I was allowed to go downstairs into the kitchen when there was really no danger of anyone coming into the house. And I would go into the kitchen down these stairs. I remember it was wonderful because, first of all, I was out of the room, but also because there were people there and there was activity and there were smells and there was something going on. So it was a wonderful thing. And I remember always sitting there watching them. And my biggest treat, what I would get, was a glass of water with sugar in it. And that was a big treat. One day I was sitting on the steps just watching the scene and listening to them talk. And I can almost see myself as I was, a little girl. By this time my hair was pretty long, pretty scrawny, skinny, sitting there. And there was a knock at the door. This was at night, in the evening. There was a knock at the door. And without thinking, one of the family just went and opened the door. And some people came in. I think there were two or three people who came in. And they started talking to the family, and all of a sudden they saw me, and they said, "Who is that?" At which point I froze. It's almost as that moment is imprinted in me forever and ever. Everybody froze because they had forgotten about me.
How did you know that that's a danger?
Because I knew that I was not allowed to be seen or heard, make noise, because they would find that the Germans would come and they would take us away. I mean, this was the threat. So I was stunned and basically got up and ran up the stairs and walked into the room, came into the room. And I'm told I remember being told by my mother that I was white as a sheet when I came in and panicky. I was 5. And what happened basically is that apparently the farmers in some way explained to them that I was a relative who had come from the south during the war, whatever, and I was somebody's child that was sent there. And I just, somehow they explained it away, I think. But I knew, even though I was 5, and even though I had no real intellectual understanding in some way, I knew that I had done something terrible. I now caused us to be discovered and then to be separated and killed, whatever that meant. But for me, separation from my mother and my father was, of course, the biggest threat. It was a terrible, terrible moment in my life.
And did you ever find out who these people were?
They were just neighbors, people, friends, relatives, you know, whatever. They just came by, a farmer, his friend or whatever. That was not the issue. The issue was that I gave us away.
Were your parents angry?
No, they were not angry. I think they were terribly worried and frightened too, and I picked up on that. So it was a terrible thing. There was no sense of comfort, although I think they tried to comfort me, but it was a terrible thing. It was a terrible thing.
We're going to change tapes again.
It was a terrible moment. You know, in retrospect, it was one of many moments. But for me, as a child, it had an incredible impact. And I felt it's as though the weight of the world on this little kid, you know. I feel sorry for myself having had that experience. It was terrible. And it made more of an impact on me probably than anybody else. So it worked out okay. They bought it. It didn't endanger us after. I mean, it endangered us, but it didn't, I guess, really was not the reason for our being discovered. I would spend hours with my father, listening to him tell me stories, and that's how he kept me occupied. My father was a wonderful storyteller. And there was a room next to the one we were in, which was filled with sacks of wheat and grain, and it was filled with ants, ants crawling all over everything. And I remember my father and I sitting in that room for hours sometimes, or it seemed hours, I guess. And he would just sit with me, and we would watch ants, and he would create these wonderful stories around these little ants. And we'd watch these ants carry little pieces of something, and they would, and he would weave these incredible tales around it. And that's how he basically kept me occupied and able to just sit quietly. He also used to tell me stories in serial form, you know, so that they always had a continuation, so that I always look forward to the next episode, which was a wonderful device that he came up with, again, to keep me occupied. And there was one story that I remember, the characters, I don't remember the specifics, because there were so many episodes. But it was Brigitte, a little girl, who lived with her grandfather, and she was, I guess, an orphan living with her grandfather. And her adventures and his adventures and theirs together and so on. And that was something that kept me going for a long time, because I always waited for the next episode.
During this period, what was your connection to your mother?
I'm sad to say that I keep saying, you know, I've thought about this. She's there. She's very much there and is there as a comfort to me. But my more vivid recollections are always with my father. Because I think he addressed me. You know, for the most part, I was this little kid. And I am sure, and I know I said this before, that I must have been a real weight, a real concern to have such a small child and not be free to move and run and be without having to consider and the noise and all of the things that go along with a little kid. So I don't know why, but I don't have major recollections of my interaction with my mother, but I have great recollection of my father. I remember sitting on his lap. I remember he smoked. And, you know, smoking was very difficult because there were no cigarettes. So he would take the cigarette butt and then take it apart and put it into other paper. Of course, he rolled his own. And every time he could get any kind of cigarette from the farmers, he would whatever. This was a big treat. And his fingers were yellow, you know, and he smelled of the smoke. And I remember that smell. And his clothes were... We had no real clothes with us. We lived, you know, we looked pretty sad. It was really, we were pretty sad looking, I think. Everybody with long hair and pale and hadn't been outdoors, you know, now months and months. Until one day we were told that there was a patrol of Germans coming through. Again, this local official let it be known that there was a patrol coming through, searching houses. And so we had to go. And that day, at dawn, it was still dark outside, the farmers took us to in the field, not far from the house, there was like a depression in the ground, a pit, a large pit. And it was covered with like blackberry bushes, you know, those prickly bushes with blackberries growing on them. And he took us there and lowered us into this pit. And it was pretty well concealed in the fields, you know, not too close to the house. And there we spent the day. And I remember that soon after he left, it started to drizzle. And we, of course, had no protection. But I remember that clearly. And I remember seeing the sky. And to me, to be outdoors was a treat, in a sense, to get air, fresh air. But it was scary because we couldn't make noise. We couldn't move. We couldn't do anything because somebody should hear us. And they then came and got us at the end of the afternoon and took us back to the house in the dark and took us back in the house. That recollection I have.
Do you remember how your sister behaved through this time.
I think of my sister in those at that time basically as just being there. I didn't have much interaction with her as well, although I'm sure we did because of the circumstances. We were together so much. But I don't have any great recollection of our having much. She was protective of me. She was very, caring. I know that. I mean, there was no sense of anger or resentment, I don't think, in any way at that point. But there was, she was just there. I don't have any real recollection of her.
Did you have any connection or contact with Italian children?
At this point? Not at all. In fact, even the children in the house, some of them didn't even know that we were there. The little ones did not know. In fact, I heard that one of them said that they heard some crying or they heard some noise and they asked, who is it, what is that up there? And they said, oh, it's nothing, it's just your imagination or whatever. They didn't even know. The bigger one, the older one, the 10, 12-year-old knew that we were there and that he must not talk about it.
Do you know whether he went to school?
No, he did not go to school, I'm fairly sure. I don't believe so. I'm not aware of it. No, he did not. It was everybody was pretty much close to the house, and I made the men work in the fields. I mean, it had to look like nothing had changed. No, I don't know about school. I don't think so.
How long were you in this house?
We were in this house maybe 6 months. I don't know exactly. I don't know exactly, but this house was very, in my memory, a very important place because of the intensity of it. And there was one incident, by the way. You know, in Italy, it is a Catholic country, and so the priests come and bless the houses around Easter time, and they actually come and they bring holy water, and they come and go into every room and they bless the room with this holy water. And so he was coming, and of course they had to come. And when it came to our room, they said, oh, you can't go in there. I don't know what excuse they gave them, some kind of an excuse. There was something going, I don't know, it was dirty or whatever, and just don't even bother with that room. And he bought it. He actually didn't. But we were just cowering in there quietly because we were, it was that close, you know, to exposure. The house, as I said, was very primitive. There was no indoor plumbing, and so, you know, to go to the bathroom, there was basically a little room with a wooden plank seat-like thing with a hole in it, and that was it. It was difficult.
Why did you finally leave this place?
Because it turned out that someone had suspicions that they were housing someone, and there was a denunciation. And so we found out about it again from this guy in town who then let us know, and we had to get out fast. And so at night, again, these people who had helped us, these young men and these farmers, they actually found us, this network of people. I don't know exactly how that worked, which is a terrible shame. But they found another house, and we were able to go to the next house.
Did you ever find out whether these people were organized?
I thought they were, but I'm not certain of it. It's terrible to say, but I have a sense that there was some kind of an underground organization of it. But I think I've asked my sister since, and she said no, that these were just people that helped us. But my sense of it was that they were actually against the Germans, were looking to. This was one way of saying, we got you. You know, this was the Italians fighting back. That was my sense of it.
Do you know the date when you left?
That house? No, but I think it was sometime maybe in April of 43.
And you went where?
We were taken by night to the next house. And again, there was a family who took us in. They were a family of a grandmother, mother, father, and a little girl that I am aware of. And they took us in, and at this point, my aunt, with her two sons, who had been in this other house, also came to join us. So that we had two rooms in this house now.
You remember the name of this family?
The last name is Bardi. And we now were in this house. Now, by this time, again, the bombardments were going on, and from this house, we could actually see the valley below, and I remember bombings and the sounds of the bombs, and I remember actually standing in the stairwell. We were actually, because the bombing was coming closer, and we would stand in this stairwell of this house, this very primitive house as well, and hearing the sounds of the bombing around us, and it was very frightening. It was frightening. Everybody was scared. In this house, we were in a room, again, there was a double bed with, again, an iron bed and a chest of drawers. And on it, I seem to remember, a large piece of gesso, like a castle-like thing. That was a souvenir somewhere. They must have picked it up. I don't know what they where they got this. It was like plaster of Paris, a white castle-like thing that was on this dresser. Again, I slept on this baule. And the reason I mention this thing is because I remember distinctly spending a lot of time fantasizing about this thing. And my father told me a lot of fairy tales. And so this castle became like a, I pretended all kinds of things with it, and I imagined all kinds of things. So my imagination was really at work there. I created a world of fairy tales and stories, and this castle somehow comes back to memory as in memory as some place where I would imagine all kinds of things.
How did you understand the difference between you and the Italian children? What was the difference?
For me at the time, I knew I was different. I knew that I was not allowed to go outside because I was different. I don't know that I knew it because I was a Jew or because I was a foreigner in this country. I understood that I was very different and that I did not belong there and that they were being very kind to keep us and that I had to be very, very good.
Did you know, for example, that on Sundays they went to church?
They didn't, because these are farmers who were far removed from, they were not necessarily all that religious on a regular basis. They were Catholics. There were crosses in some of the rooms, or they had their rosaries around. But they were not, they would not necessarily go to church on Sunday. It was not that kind of regular observance on their part. And I don't even know that the Jewish issue was an issue for them, as I said, you know. They really thought of us as just being strangers in the, who were being hunted or looked for. And I suspect they knew we were Jewish, but what that represented to them, I really don't know. I know that if they had been discovered to be hiding us, they would have been killed on the spot. And it happened in many cases where families that did this were put against the wall and the entire family was shot, from grandparents to small babies, because that was the punishment. So they knew that there was a major risk, but they did it anyway. And that's a wonder to me.
Was life in this house different from the other?
Yes. And the reason it was different was because now I had my cousin. My cousin, who was my age, and his brother, who was about 7 years older, or 5, 7 years older than he. But my cousin, who was, as I said, a year and a half older than I. So I was 5, almost 6, I guess, at this point, and he was 7, almost 8, I guess. And so he and I played together. And I remember distinctly my father, when he was with us, which was not very often by this point, would help us with cutouts with paper, and we would make little carts and little figures and little towns and houses just to construct little things as playthings, as toys. And, you know, using flour and water for glue and just very primitive, obviously. But I remember this because my cousins played with this and I played with them with it. And I also remember playing with my cousin and discovering the differences between boy and girl. I remember, even under those circumstances, one time in the room, in our room, we were alone, he and I, and I remember even the place where this was, and he for some reason, you know, he wanted, I don't know if he had pulled his pants down or something, and I said, "What's that?" You know, we discovered the fact that we were different, and he knew more because he was older, but I didn't know. And, you know, and so even in those circumstances, to basically go through those experiences, I think is pretty wonderful when you consider that. There was a little girl that was the child of the family, and she would come up, and she was at three at the time, so the sense was that it was fairly safe to play with her or have her play with us. And she would come upstairs sometimes, and I remember there was a sense of playing doctor and exploration, you know, and all of the things that little kids do to learn these things. And so this was going on. So it's interesting to see, you know, the human need to do all of that still existed even under those circumstances. But so it was different because I had some company. I was not all by myself with adults, and that was different.
Did your father try to teach you read or count?
He probably did, but he taught my... This was earlier when we were living in this villa. I know, spent time with my sister and cousins because they had no schooling either. He taught them. He was their teacher, and I think they had a tutor for a little time, but there was no schooling. I did not really get. He may have shown me basics, but there were no books really available. There were no things, lots of paper and pencils and things. It was all very difficult, but he probably did. I don't remember that specifically, but I know he spoke a lot to me. He told me a lot. He used the time that he had with me, which was not very long. And the reason it wasn't long is because the men were sought out in that area again for labor, for the Germans who were there. And so the men had to go and hide in the woods. And my father spent quite a bit of time in the woods above this house in the mountain, where there were actually shelter, like a cave or some kind of shelter, that he spent days and days on end. And then the farmers would sometimes come back, and he would actually take food to him, and he would come back. And then German patrols started coming through the area. There was a network of, you asked me before about any organized effort. I remember that one thing that comes to mind is that when the Germans would come through the area, the patrols would come through, down the mountain, down the hillside, there were farmhouses, and when the Germans would get there, they would hang a white sheet out the window. Now, if there was a white sheet out that window, it meant to all those people up the mountain that the Germans were coming, and so that there were always white sheets, always. So that meant we had to go and find some hiding places. And initially for the men, because we, you know, felt the Italian women were left basically on the farms, but it was the men they were looking for. So at one point, it got so that there were patrols that would go by the house, and the road was right up against the house. So that we actually heard the vehicles. They were armored cars, and to me sounding like tanks, but I can't imagine a tank on these little roads. But the house almost shook. It was noisy, and they were right there, and we were in this room. And the proximity of that danger is something that I can still feel. It was so imminent, so scary, so frightening. But my father, at one point, the farmer dug a hole in the field next to the house, or in the field nearby the house. There was a hole built, the dug. And my father spent the days, several days, in this hole covered with straw. And that's how he spent his days. And at night, he would come out in the dark. And I remember him coming back into our room. And I remember the feeling and the smell of this man who smelled like damp earth, you know, that damp odor. He just smelled of it, and his clothes were full of it. And yet it felt so good to just sit on his lap, you know, and it was such a comforting feeling to have him there. But it was always very brief, you know. He was not around very much during that particular time because it was so dangerous for him to be there. Because these German patrols were coming through houses and just searching, and one day they came into the house, and I vividly remember the Germans coming in. And the German came in, the soldier came in, and actually pushed the door open to our room. And the farmer woman came up with him. And I remember where the placement in the room of where my mother stood, my sister stood, and where I was. And we froze again in place. And my sister did the speaking because she, her Italian was better, of course, and no accent at this point, or less of it, if any. And he basically came in with this gun. Now, it, I don't know what kind of a gun or a rifle or what it was, but to me it looked like a cannon. And it pointed at us, and he asked where the men were, in Italian. He asked where the men. And the farm woman said, the men are gone, they've been taken already. And he said, who are these people? And she explained that we were relatives who had come from the south because of the war. And we cowered. And my aunt in the other room with my cousins. And at one point, he went looking with his gun into everything, and there was this little closet of a place where was a, this, again, a seat with a hole in it. This was like our toilet. And he even went in there and looked around. And my cousin, my older cousin of 12 at the point, at that time, I guess, a little, a boy, I think he was there, yes. He said something. He got in the, he moved along with him for some reason, and my aunt said in German something like, get out of the way, or don't, you know, to him, to my cousin. And, you know, he didn't hear it. The German didn't hear it. But she almost, that was another moment where it was like a, you know, it's your heart stands still. It was a frightening experience because I saw firsthand this monster, this the German, you know, the enemy was right there, confronted with it, and it, we could have just been taken away and killed immediately or separated from my mother and whatever, but we survived that too.
At this point, what language did you, amongst yourselves, use?
German, because my mother, of course, having lived in Austria and even in Yugoslavia with a lot of German, there was the Austro-Hungarian, you know, part of the world, in that part of the world where there was a lot of mixture of German. And so German was the language we spoke.
And the children?
We spoke German. I spoke German because that's how I communicated with my mother. And the Italian was really, I don't know how much Italian, I spoke Italian by this point, but I don't, I think German was the language really that in which we communicated. Although we spoke Italian to the farmers.
So how long was this situation?
We were there until September of 44. So we were actually in deep hiding from September of 43 to September of 44, a year. In September of 44, a patrol of friendly soldiers came by. We heard that the Allies were in the area. We knew that hopefully that we were going to be, they were going to come through, and there was a sense of expectation. And one day they came through. One thing I want to mention that, to go back to myself as a child in these circumstances, you know, I remember being very willful and sometimes crying, wanting something and not getting my way, of course, and crying. And when I cried, I remember being put on the bed and having pillows put over my head because the crying was too noisy and loud and people might hear it. And I remember being very resentful of that because not only was I resentful from the whatever it was that made me cry, but then I was not even allowed to express my resentment. And it was something that I'll not forget either. The sense, this rage that I felt that I could not really express, and these pillows over my head.
What did you understand about that?
I couldn't make noise. I was allowed. I had to be a very quiet, good little girl. Be very good. Be very still. Be very quiet. Never tell, talk. Never, if you talk, just to us quietly. You know, if anybody ever asked any question, but that was not even a point because we never had contact with anyone else. Be very quiet and very still, no noise.
When the friendly soldiers came, how did you understand that these were friendly soldiers?
I just remember the joy around me. I remember this just this joy, this disbelief. And the soldier who came into the house, who found us ultimately, happened to be a South African, of a South African unit that was with this Allied force. And he was a Jew, a South African Jew, who was astounded, I guess, to find us there. And I don't remember clearly that moment, but I do remember the elation around me, the joy, you know, the relief, the sense of safety in some way that everyone felt. And I just know this was a happy time. I cannot give you the exact moment that I recognized, but I remember people hugging and, you know, just couldn't believe it. Everybody was like astounded.
Did you recognize that there is going to be a change in your life now?
No, I didn't know, because I was too little to really realize any of that. But there was a change. And the change was, first of all, that we were allowed to go outside. And to a little kid who had been cooped up for a year without being able to run or be outside, this was a major change. And I remember distinctly the day that I was allowed to go outside for the first time. And my cousin and I were told, okay, go outside. And we were like, at first, I think, very careful. And then we realized that we had some freedom to do what we wanted. And there was a hill on the back of the house. And we ran down this hill. We just ran down this hill. It was, I can remember the feeling, the laughing, the two of us just running down this hill, you know. It was a wonderful moment. The sad thing about it, though, was that we had to go back up that hill. And not having used our legs for so long, it was very painful. And for days and days, I remember having the ache. It was like when you don't exercise and you start exercising. And the use of muscles that had not been used in such a long time. Remember, we did not have nourishment. We were all very skinny and pale. I was a scrawny little kid, and so this was, it was an emotional moment, but I remember the pain associated with it. It's as though I couldn't quite enjoy it either.
How did the Italians deal with liberation?
I wish I could be more clear about the farmers' reaction. I don't know. I don't remember exactly. But I suspect that they too were very, very relieved. First of all, because they themselves were freer and now of this worry, but also because that meant that we would no longer be one of their concerns. There is an incident that I just want to mention here. I need to mention it because it is a memory that I have that is very vivid for me, which is still during that hiding period.
Why don't we wait with that after we change the tape? Tell us a story about.
Yeah, I want to tell it because it has to do with my memory, and I like to bring up those memories. It has to do with a time when we were still in this house before liberation, sometime before liberation, and we again having to deal with the patrols that were coming through, the Germans, and so threatened by it. So we had to, and they were going through the houses thoroughly this time. So we were taken up into the mountain where my father had been and basically spent a couple of nights, I think one or two nights there. and days. And this was in the woods, and I remember this was, I guess, close to the end of summer, I guess, and so there were leaves on the ground, and it was all very crinkly noises, and there were rats and things or animals scurrying around. It was scary. And we were there, huddled there, the farmer was supposed to come and pick us up, take us back. And when it came time for him to come, he didn't come. And we were in this place on the side of this mountain and wanted to get back to the house, didn't know what to do. So we waited and waited, and he didn't come. And so we decided that we would do it on our own. But the terrible thing about this is that we had never come to this house except by night. And we really did not know exactly what the house looked like from the outside or where it was exactly, because we were taken at night always, and it was difficult. And so again at night, and there was moon at this time, we basically came down this mountain, and my father thought he could find the place because he had gone back and forth a few times, but he wasn't 100% sure. And so we're walking on this mountain road, and I tell you, I remember the scene, and I remember holding somebody's hand, and we were walking on this road, and walking and walking, and it's scary, and there are houses, and there are dogs barking as we go by some of the houses. I can almost hear the dog barking, you know. And the fear is that anybody, all of a sudden, somebody will come outside and say, "Who are you?" And what do we say? And where do we go? And we walked and walked, and we took a chance on this one house. My father thought this was it, and it was. It was. It was luck. It was luck. And we came there. There was a sense of relief. But I remember this walk at night in this, on this road with, again, you know, being outdoors was a treat, but not under these circumstances. It was so frightening. I am very aware of the fear that existed around me so much of the time. I lived with this atmosphere of terror and fear. Now, I don't know if the adults remember it that way, but I, as a child, remember that. And that is a big issue to me, to have lived so much with so much fear around me. Anyway, we made it back. To this day, when I walk at night somewhere, or if I hear a dog barking at night, I always flash on that scene. It is something that will always remain with me because it was imprinted on me. You know, these are moments that are not meaningful to anybody but to me. So liberation, we were taken by jeep, and by this time my aunts and uncles from the other house were also liberated, and we were all taken to an encampment of the Allied soldiers who were on the other side of the mountain. And I remember getting there to this encampment, and it was sort of a new world. It was a strange world, all these soldiers around, and there was food. And the first thing, of course, they asked us was, "What do you want to eat?" Which was a silly question, because we wouldn't eat anything. We were not starved. We had been fed, but it was certainly a treat to have something else beside whatever we ate there, cabbage or greens and whatever, potatoes. But the first thing they offered me, "What would you like to eat?" I said, "Anything." And they offered me, and I remember this, it seems silly, but it is really memorable for me, and that is they offered me a piece of white bread, like Wonder Bread, you know, the bread that they sliced at the time, and a piece of white bread with some oleomargarine on it, you know, the thick oleomargarine, this margarine. And they spread it on, and they gave me this piece of bread with the margarine, and to me that was heaven. It was a, you know, it's all relative. But to me, that was such a treat. It was wonderful. And they put some jelly on it. I mean, this was wonderful. And I was hungry, I guess, for this.
Do you remember the date when you came to this camp? And what was it called? Where was it?
It was not a camp. It was just soldiers encamped on a mountainside until they moved on to the next. Because the war was still going on. The Germans were still in the area. We just happened to be now with the Allies, which was safety.
Do you know when this was?
This was in September of 44. September of 44. September seemed to be a month for us. Everything seemed to happen in September. And September of 44 was when this happened. I don't have the exact date. perhaps the 9th of September, but I can't swear to that. And now we were with the Allies, and they moved, and there we actually spent a night or two, I think, in some other house that was nearby there. And so, but the feeling was at least we had some sense of security, even though even they were in danger because they were still at war. The war was still going on, actually. It was September of 1944, and Italy was still, there were still pockets of Germans in the area. So we were then taken back to the villa where we had started from in the first place. And the Allies actually used that as somewhat of a headquarters for a time. And we spent a few weeks there. And that was coming back to this place. Most of our whatever belongings we had had were gone. A few things perhaps were left.
Was this in Monte Catini?
No, in Quarata. This was at the side of the side of this hill, beautiful hill, in this villa that we had originally come to, that this Mr. Lenzi had allowed us to live in. And so we came back to that place, and it had electricity now, even though most of the area did not, and that was because the Allies had generators, and there were generators there, and we had food, and we had wonderful things that, you know, we couldn't have dreamed of just a few weeks and months before. And there was music. I remember the Americans having their, you know, a record player, I think, with a crank or some record player or radio where there was American music, you know, the pop music or the sounds of the time. And my cousins and my sister, who were by this time, you know, 15, 16 years old, very pretty, you know, and liking being around these young men and the attention they got. It was a moment of elation, in a sense, you know. But then reality struck, and that is, where do we go next? What do we do now?
Let me ask you, when the Allies took you back to this chateau...
Let's not go too far. It was not a chateau. It was a lovely old house, two-story house.
Do you know whether your parents or the adults talked about the Italians who helped you?
They did, I guess. I'm not I was not part of these discussions, but I know that they appreciated the Italians, and they were terribly grateful for what they had done. Is that what you mean?
No, I'm asking whether they talked to the Allies
about them. I'm sure they did. I am sure they talked about the fact that the Italians were the ones who really saved our lives. And in all of these cases, these were people who were really uneducated, very simple, but incredibly generous, wonderful people who did this, knowing full well that there was some great danger in doing that, you know. And I have since asked them, those who survived, why they did that. And the answer has always been, why not, basically. That's what we did. We did. It was just a matter of fact, strange. I have had to ask myself, if I were confronted with that, if somebody came knocking on my door and said, hide this family, but know that your family might be in danger, you know, at doing that, would I do that? And I'm not sure. And this is knowing what I know. Amazing.
So what happened then?
Then we moved to Florence. And my uncle with his wife and children basically took residence in an apartment. He always had a way of making life very nice for himself. He had resources in some way that we did not have. We were the poor relations, in a sense. My father, who really had no great experience in doing any work other than the business that he had was involved in before the war, began selling souvenirs, little Florentine souvenirs, like a little stand. He thought that that would be something he could do. And in fact, he did pretty well. And the reason he did well is because he spoke languages and he spoke English. And so the American soldiers who were there, and this was the Fifth Army that came through Italy, that part of Italy. The American soldiers in Florence after the war who were there were really very happy to find someone, number one, who spoke English, and number two, who catered to them. So my father, doing pretty well in selling these little trinkets and Florentine souvenirs, rented a space in an existing store right on the main square in Florence, on the Piazza del Duomo, which is the dome, and had a little space in the store, a textile store, which was there for many years. And he had a window to the outside, which he decorated. And he would decorate it in English, with signs in English, and also marking the holidays, for instance, Mother's Day, Valentine's Day, Easter, and would do this in a very artistic and very clever way using English, so that American soldiers found this to be like an oasis, and they would come, and we basically had an incredible number of soldiers who became friends, and they befriended us, and my father, and my mother, and of course my very pretty sister. So that was sort of a draw. And my father began doing very well financially. He was very successful in a very short time, so much so that he actually opened up, again, concessions at various PXs, in various PX being the Americans merchandise. I don't know what it stands for. Procurement something, perhaps. In some of their camps throughout Italy, in various parts of Italy. And he actually had little branches of these souvenirs. And so he did quite well in a matter of a very short time. The problem, though, was that he was on the road a lot, worked very hard. And we lived in a pension, in a boarding house in Florence, right after the war, where we actually just had one room in this boarding house. My mother cooked in that kitchen, and we lived in this one room. I was, at this point, I guess, 7, and was actually going to school, as my sister and cousins were, going to school in a English convent, English nuns that had a school in Florence. We, for some reason, I'm not sure why, went to that school. My sister and cousins had not had any schooling in a long time, so this was their first experience for so many years. But they basically were taken in. And I went to kindergarten there. And I remember learning little songs in English and being with the children for the first time. And my father would come and pick me up sometimes, and we would walk home together. I remember this time very fondly, because at this particular time when my father was around, I would spend a lot of time with him, and he again would tell me stories. And because of all the friends that we had made among the American soldiers, we had lots of goodies and food. I remember drawers in my mother and father's chest of drawers filled with chocolate and candy and all kinds of things. And they brought stockings, you know, nylon stockings for, and meat. They actually would take meat from their commissary and would give it to us, which was a rare thing to have. And we would sit at night, I remember, in this room with some of the soldiers who would come and visit us, and sitting in my father's lap, and I would listen, just listen a lot, and would fall asleep on his lap. This was almost a nightly ritual. And I remember sitting on his lap, and he didn't have nice clothes, but he had a jacket. They were like a tweed jacket, and again, he smoked. And I remember just sort of nestling into his lap and the smell of his jacket, and just sitting on this lap and feeling this warmth. And it was one of the most wonderful feelings that any child could have, I think. I consider that as a basis for who I am and what I am today. You know, that kind of warmth and relationship that I had with him. It served me, I think, to this day and probably to the day I die. He was just wonderful with me. I think that he gave me truly unconditional love. He was very, very lenient with me. I was pretty willful, but he was very good. I never remember him scolding me, or I once had a spanking once, and I don't remember why, but that was very unusual thing. I remember sitting on Sunday morning in the bed with him. My mother was in the kitchen, and she cooked at that time. The treat was, of course, bacon, which the soldiers gave us. And so we had eggs and bacon, very American. And she would bring it to us in this room that they finally had to themselves. We actually, at that point, had two rooms in this boarding house. First time that my father and mother had some privacy in all these years. We would sit in bed, and he would tell me about things like how do the planets work, and how does the sun and the moon and the earth and the trains work, and all of the things that you learn as a kid, all the questions you have, and why does this happen, and how does this happen, and he would tell me. And these are the memories that I have of him, and they're powerful memories, very powerful basis for who I am today.
Let's go back for a moment. While you were in hiding, you were telling us that your parents came from large families. Did you know anything about the rest of the family?
No. We knew that my uncle, my aunt's husband, my cousin, you know, the man who was in Jasenovac, I guess, had disappeared. We did not know at that point what had happened to him. We did not really know about my grandparents. My one grandmother was with us. My mother's mother was with us. My other grandparents, my father found out at some point, I'm not sure how, but he found out that they had been deported. So he was, as I'm told, actually in mourning for his parents because he did not know if they were alive or not. And that's all we really knew. We did not know about anyone else.
Do you remember during the hiding period anything about religion as a Jew?
No, we did not. There was no real practice of any religious ceremony or any religious aspect of it. I don't remember any of it. I knew I was Jewish, whatever that meant at the time when I was that little. But that was it. There was really not. And I think it's because my family was really quite assimilated, as I said. And under these circumstances, it was very difficult. But no, they did not come from such observant homes in the first place. So that it was not. We were not in any way observant. It's possible that when there were the holidays, that we were aware of them. I don't remember any mention of it.
How about after liberation?
After liberation, I then, after doing this time in this English Catholic nuns school, was actually sent to Hebrew school for the first grade. And there was a temple in Florence, there still is, one of the most beautiful temples in Italy. And near it, right next to it, was a school for children, the Jewish children of Florence. And I actually attended first grade there. So that was my first real contact with religious aspect, and that was really very little in the first grade, but that was when I first became involved in any way.
Do you know when did your parents had the first contact with Italian Jews? Or was there such a contact?
There was not a conscious effort. Italians were really, my experience, and I think it's a pretty universal one for most of us who were there, that the Italians were not anti-Semitic. There was no great distinction made, you're Jews. We were Jews, and we were the Ebrei, but it didn't have the hatred behind it. It didn't have that negative meaning that it seems that it has in so many places. We were not, it was not that feeling at all. So,
but were there any Italian Jews?
There were
around?
Italian Jews, of course. So here I was now in this community going to Hebrew school. It was a school. It was a regular school, but it was in the Hebrew, under Hebrew auspices. And the temple was there, and I remember being part of that. My sister at that time also, almost very soon after the beginning of our time in Florence, with my cousins, met some young men. And one young man she met at a party New Year's Eve, I believe it was from 1945 to 1946, that New Year's Eve. And he happened to be a Jew, and he happened to be someone who was from a Jewish family in Florence, and he happens to be my brother-in-law. They met at that time. In fact, they just celebrated their 50th wedding anniversary, and in Florence, and I was there with them, which was wonderful. They met, and so he, I think, through his family, perhaps, you know, that was, in a sense, some connection to the Jewish community. But basically, there was no real effort made, except we were under, with the help of the joint distribution committee, which helped us financially, and we did obtain help in that way. The terrible thing is, though, that my father, soon after all of this happened, because all of this supposed, this financial growth and success basically happened very quickly after the war, he became ill. He actually came down with TB. And so he could not continue to work. And he became so ill that he had to be hospitalized and spent the next 3 years in sanatoriums in Italy, in various parts of Italy, and that's when our life changed course completely again. So he had done well enough to have a little money, and that money sustained us basically for his time during his illness for the part of it. And my mother spent the next 3 years basically caring for my father, being with him every single day in the hospitals. And I basically spent my time either with my sister or with a woman that they hired to take care of me, or with my grandmother on my father's part. My grandmother, who had been in Theresienstadt and who lost my grandfather, he died soon after he arrived at Theresienstadt. She survived it and ultimately ended up in Switzerland. And from there, when we discovered where she was, my father tracked it down. We brought her to Italy, and she came and lived with us in Florence for some time. And when my father became ill, my grandmother basically was there with me. And she was a woman who was not very warm or outgoing. She was, I remember her as just being there. So I was pretty much left on my own devices a lot. And my father was very ill. And while he was so ill, I was actually sent back to some of the farmers to spend some time there, because I was somewhat of a burden to take care of this little girl when all these things were going on. And so I spent some weeks in the summer, for instance, back at the very places where we were in hiding.
Did you later find out where did the Italian Jews, how did they survive?
What I found out is that initially the Italian Jews were not deported. As long as Mussolini was there, they were allowed to remain with many restrictions. But when the Germans came in, Italian Jews were deported, and deported from everywhere. And those who were not were in hiding, and actually went off and were hidden, as we were in other circumstances. So some of them had similar experiences in that they were hidden. So, I must say that that only happened. So those who were deported, very, very few came back. Florence lost most of those who were deported did not come back, and so for many of the communities. That is what I know and learned afterwards.
Now, you said you were in a DP camp.
That comes much later. That comes later. That comes after the next 3 years when we followed my father around from place to place in his illness. after the war, I also had some lung problems, and they were very worried that I would have what my father had, TB. And so I remember I had pleurisy, and I remember being bedridden quite a bit, and being somewhat sickly. And I also, I think, being sickly meant that I got attention. And being sickly meant that my mother would be there for me, because she was this caregiver person. And since she wasn't around very much, you know. But she basically, so I remember being in bed and sick a few times. But this pleurisy was a problem because they were worried. They actually brought x-ray machines into this place and x-rayed my father, and I would have to go and have fluoroscopy once a week, which turned out to be, I think, a very unfortunately damaging thing in my life later on. But I made it okay, and my father did not. And for the next 3 years, as I said, we followed him around. And we first followed him to a little town in Italy, in the lake region outside of Lago Maggiore, in this little town called Miazzina, which had a sanitarium that the joint had made arrangements with to house some survivors who had lung problems. And he lived there, and we lived in a place in this place for several months. My grandmother, who was with us then, my father's mother, left from there and emigrated to the United States to join family here. And my mother's sister and I remained, and then followed my father to the next location, which was a city called Merano in northern Italy, where he ultimately died. And he was in a sanitarium in Merano, which is a sanitarium which was built, I think, at the end of the last century, and it was a Jewish sanitarium for Jews with lung diseases, even at the turn of the century. And so he basically was sent there, and we joined him there and spent the next year or so in that city.
Do you remember your father's death?
I do. My father, because he had TB, I was not allowed to go near him. And here was a man who I wanted so very much to be physically close to. It was very difficult for me, but I was not allowed to go near him. And the most I could do when there was times in Merano where he was somewhat better was that I was allowed to sit on a bench outside in this garden, and I would sit on the one end of the bench and he would sit on the other, and he would again talk to me. These conversations were always going on. But that was very rare. It happened maybe once or twice. But for the most part, for the next 3 years, between the age of 7 and 10, which is when he died, I saw him from a distance, and I waved to him, and he waved to me. And he had a room that had a balcony, and he would always stand on that balcony and wave to me and wave to us as we were leaving, or that's how I remember him. It was very difficult because I wanted so very much to be near him.
When did he die?
He died in September, again, of 1948.
And then what happened to the family?
During this period, my mother, as I said, was with him every day, literally. And my sister was off working, trying to make a little money, and also living her life. By this time, she was engaged to my brother-in-law, who was in visiting us from Florence.
What kind of work did she do?
Knitting. She worked for people, just, you know, she was good at knitting, and she did small things. But for the most part, I was alone. So when my father died, I was informed about it. It was very painful, very difficult, and I can tell you about that.
Okay, we're going to change tapes.
My father died, I remember the day clearly, my sister coming and telling me that I knew that he had gotten sicker, and so he was very sick, and they were very worried. I basically was a lot on my own during this time, and I went to school. You know, every town we lived in, I went to those schools, so I moved schools a lot. But she came in and told me that he had died, and of course, the crying, the pain of that, I remember she was brushing my hair, and she says, I need to tell you something. And that moment is also just frozen in place for me, because I couldn't believe it. And the terrible thing about that for me was that they did not allow me to go to the funeral. In Merano, there is a Jewish community. It's an old, old Jewish community. There's a temple, a small temple, and a cemetery. And he was to be buried right away, because it was, I believe the Jewish holidays were coming. He died on September 3rd, and this either the Jewish holidays or a Saturday was somehow, he had to be buried very, like the next day practically. And I had no chance to really take this in some way. And I wanted to go to the funeral, and some family came from other places to join my mother and sister and me, to go to, you know, to his funeral. And everyone went, and I was left by myself in this, again, a boarding house that we lived in. And I somewhere am so resentful of that to this day, you know, that I was
not allowed. How old were you?
I was almost 10. And I remember sitting there thinking, he's really not dead, and they're burying him alive. Which I understand is a very common thing for children to undergo in that circumstance, but I really did not believe that he was dead. And they were burying him alive. He was really not dead, and it was a terrible thing. It was a terrible thing. I was all alone. There was no one else around, and so that was very painful. Children were not thought to be going to go to a funeral in those days. You just don't do that, and certainly not to a cemetery. You don't do that. But he was buried in the Jewish way, with the Jewish community there, and in the Jewish cemetery, and where I still visit whenever I can.
So what happened after his death?
After he died, we stayed some time in Milano with some my relatives, and then we moved to Florence, where my sister was married in 1949. And my mother and I basically began, she began working, had to get a job of some sort, was a clerk in a store. And again, I was on my own. I spent a lot of time alone. But because I'm pretty outgoing, I made friends easily, I always had friends. And again, attended Hebrew school in Florence. And so I completed, I believe it was the fifth grade now, in Florence, and was part of the Hanukkah plays and belonged to the Tzofim, which is the Jewish scouts, and became a Zionist. I was going to go to Israel and really work the land and be part of that whole movement in that time. This was 1949, so it was all very exciting. And but my mother, of course, wanted, and rightly so, to come to this country, which is my father's wish too, but unfortunately he never could make it. So we had a relative, my father's brother, and his wife, who turns out to be my mother's sister, two brothers married two sisters, lived in already in Los Angeles. They came at the very last way they were able to get out through Russia, Shanghai, somehow they made it here. And so we basically, my mother and I, then did everything we could to come to this country. And we had to go through all of the legal procedures. That meant having to get an affidavit, which my uncle sent us from here, and also had to be healthy, otherwise we would not be accepted. And so to go through that process, we had to go through the DP camps, which were specifically put in place to do this processing of immigrants to the United States. And so we were we would travel, my mother and I, from Florence to Bagnoli, which is a little town outside of Napoli, Naples, which was an old army base which was made into this DP camp. And we lived there in some not so great conditions, on and off for months. We would always go back to Florence, maybe spend a week or two, and then go back. And we basically were checked from head to toe. and were thrown back a couple of times because I had these scars on my lung, because they thought I had some eye disease, which turned out to be not true, was a mistake. It was a difficult time because it was it was very hard to make it through to this country.
So where did you go from?
Finally, from Bagnoli, we finally were given the okay. And after saying goodbye to family in Florence, leaving my sister behind with my brother-in-law and his family, we came to the United States. And we did that by traveling by train from Naples all the way up to near Bremerhaven in Germany. There was a DP camp where we were then to be, from there we were to embark on a ship to come to the United States. For many years, there were DP ships that left Naples directly to the United States, but by the time we got there, that was no longer possible. So we actually had to travel through through Austria to get to Germany, and then, which was difficult.
Where did you embark?
In Bremerhaven. We stayed in this DP camp for 10 days, and I just want to mention that the processing at this DP camp was really a very difficult experience, because the train that brought us, this was after 3 days of on third class, which was wooden benches, so we couldn't really sleep. Or after 3 days, we arrived in this place, and the train pulled into the camp on the tracks, and we were told to get out, and we were told to go into this gathering hall, and we were given a bar of soap, and we were given a blanket, and we were told to take a shower. Now, I knew enough, having learned about the camps during the war, about the wartime, of the intake procedures when people arrived in a camp, and how often that kind of experience, and just coming there and going through this experience, thinking of those people particularly who had already gone through this, who were with us, other women, other men, who had survived the camps and then had to go through this experience again. You know, I remember we were told to take our clothes off and to take a shower. And this was the first time that I was basically in a room with all these naked women, and I was a little girl, I was 12 years old. I remember being very frightened, and when you think back, you know, it was a terrible thing to put people through. Even though this was a joyful time, we were about to go to the United States, finally, but there was this last reminder in some way. It was a cruel thing in some way.
But how did you know what happened?
I knew because after the war, we learned from those who returned, who survived, and there were not many. And from hearing and reading and reports from survivors, camp survivors, about what happened in some of these things, you know, we heard of these experiences and how this was done. So we left from there.
Do you remember the name of the ship?
Yes. The name of the ship was the Captain Muir. Our last experience on European soil was also very difficult, because on this train now from the DP camp where we had spent 10 days to the ship when it came our turn to go, we were in a compartment with several other people. We were not allowed to have any money on us because we were supposedly displaced persons. We had nothing, and we didn't. But my mother had $300, and she had in her clothes. She had either sewn it or put it in some way, hidden it in her clothes. And in this particular compartment, there were people who apparently had smuggled money, but big money, I guess. And somehow someone discovered that. So when we arrived at this ship, at this place where the train stopped by the ship, we were not allowed to get out of this compartment. We didn't understand why. Everybody got off, everybody left, except those of us who were in this compartment. And they took us to a special office. And we found out that there was money being smuggled by some man in this compartment, and therefore everyone in this compartment was suspect. And everybody was to be searched. So my mother was strip searched. And I was basically, they just searched my clothes, but I was just outside of the room. And they went through her clothes, and they found, of course, the money, and they took it. And basically, she was left with $11. For some reason, I remember that amount. And So we ended up being the very last people getting on this boat, my mother and I. We were so worried that we would not make the boat. It was, it was stressful. It was like one event after another. Coming to this country was very stressful all the way. But we made it on the boat and on the ship. And we got on the ship, and of course it was a troop transport ship, so it was not a luxury liner. It had a cafeteria, and it had hammocks. And because we were the last to get aboard, we were at the very bottom level, right above the engine room, I guess. And we were in these hammocks in a room which I think contained probably around 200, 250 people in stacks, women. As soon as we left and the ship started pulling off, of course, everyone was very happy, right? We're finally on our way to the United States. But immediately we started feeling a little funny because the ship was, well, as it turned out, the next 5 days were sheer hell because we suffered from terrible seasickness. I remember the first day going to the cafeteria and noticing that there were lips along the sides of the tables and wondering why, what was that for? And so, of course, I found out because the ship would go like this and the trays would go like that. And I never entered that cafeteria again for the next 5 days of a 9-day journey. And it was really very, very terrible. We were very sick. We actually had to be carried. There were some young men that we had befriended in this DP camp in Germany who then were on the ship, and they helped us. They carried us to the infirmary, my mother and me, and we were given something which didn't particularly help. It was March, and it was the worst of times to be on the Atlantic because it's very rough, and the waves were coming over the side of the ship. It was terrible. It was awful, and people were sick all over. It was just hell. The only thing that saved me was a Coke machine. One of the crew gave me a dime and told me, drink a Coke, it will help you. And I had my first Coke, and it saved my life.
Do you remember arriving?
Yes.
To New York?
Yes.
Coming
wonderful,
to New York.
Wonderful. It was a memorable moment. We knew that this was a 9-day trip. We knew that we were coming close. And we were told that the next day we would be coming to the United States. That night, we were all on deck on top. The whole, however many hundreds, probably close to 2,000 people on this ship. And we were on this, and suddenly we started seeing little flickers of light. And as we stood there, we watched more little lights and more little lights. And it came closer and closer, and we spent the entire night on the board of this, on the top of this ship. And as we came closer and closer, and we saw traffic in the distance, and we saw New York skyline. And of course, the most beautiful sight of all, we saw the Statue of Liberty.
Did you know what it meant?
Yes. I'm still emotional about it. Because it meant... It meant a new opening up, a new life. It meant hope. It meant a new beginning with all that pain behind us. It was lit up. It was beautiful. We went right by it. People were crying and hugging and singing and embracing. And that went on for hours. And I couldn't go to sleep. It was one of the most moving and beautiful sights that I had ever, and since then have ever, been part of and experienced. Because it not only because of the beauty of it, the lights at night, but the meaning of it, after all of that, it was very powerful. And everyone on that ship, of course, felt the same way. And so we arrived, and at 6 o'clock in the morning, we were supposed to disembark. And we did, and we knew, and we had family in New York. My aunt and uncle, who had been with us in hiding, had preceded us, and they were coming to pick us up. And we arrived, and there was this large pier with all the luggage that was taken off was to be under the letter of the name of your name. And so you were supposed to stand there until your luggage, whatever you had, would come off, and then you could leave, be processed out. And we waited and waited and waited, and people started leaving and leaving, and our luggage was not coming off the ship. And we couldn't figure out why. Meantime, we could see my relatives. They were waving at us in the background, and we could not leave. We were there all day, from 6 in the morning until in the afternoon, late. And we were panicky. We didn't know what to do. And so finally, my mother decided that she would start walking around looking, you know, maybe. And sure enough, they put it on the wrong letter. And so even that last moment was a, you know, it was like coming to America was, it took many years and a lot of pain, but we arrived.
So and where did you go first?
The HIAS, which was the organization, Jewish organization that helped us, had us stay at a hotel the first few nights. And from there, we then went to live with my aunt and uncle, first in a room, and then they took us in. Into their apartment, and we lived in New York for the next 4 months, my mother and I. It was very difficult. She needed to find work, and worked it as a rag picker. And I went to school. 2 weeks after I arrived, I was put in school. And I did not speak English. I'd only had a couple of lessons before leaving Italy. And I went to school, I was enrolled, and I sat quietly for weeks and weeks and listened. And just listen until I had enough nerve to say a few things, and I began to speak, and I haven't shut up since.
Where did you go from New York?
We stayed in New York for 4 months, and then we came to California to then join my father's brother and my mother's sister here, and lived in Los Angeles and have been since here since. So this was in 1951. The beginning was very difficult. My mother had to find work.
She
worked in a clothing factory, piecework. She worked knitting in a knitting factory. She worked, became a floor lady in some factory. I mean, she did basically garment. That was all she could find. In a shoe factory. Very hard. And then she became a caregiver again, a baby nurse. Took care of elderly people, and that's how she basically made some money later on. For 20 years, my mother was a widow, and my mother was a widow, truly a widow for that time. She was a depressed woman after my father died. She was very joyless. And I basically, as a 12-year-old kid, took over in a lot of ways. And was very independent, and she needed assistance a lot, help. My aunt here helped her tremendously, but she was depressed. She was very down. My mother and father had a wonderful marriage, and she lost him at a very young age. They were both 45 when he died, and loved each other very much, and to her this was the loss of her life. And so for 20 years, she basically was in that widow state. And I was not happy because it was not a happy situation for me. I did make friends. I am not shy, and I made friends easily. But I have to say that I was never fully accepted. I went to junior high school here. I went to high school here. And even though I tried very hard to be part of one of the kids, I never really felt part of the group. I always have felt an outsider and different. I learned to speak the language and really made an effort not to have an accent. I tried to assimilate as best I could, but no matter how I tried, I was always very responsible, very adult, very grown up, way beyond all of the kids that I was with. They had a lot more fun than I had. And so I was sort of a stick in the mud for some of them.
What kind of education did you get?
I only went through high school here because soon after high school, and by the way, I worked throughout my school years in high school. I worked in a cafeteria. I had to earn money. And I worked to earn money for myself, for my clothes, and to help in whatever way I could. I began by babysitting when I first came to this country as a mother's helper. I worked all along. So after high school, I married right out of high school. I met my first husband when I was 16, while I was in high school. He was 19 in college at the time, and was anxious to basically establish my own home and to get away from my, not that my mother was cruel or unkind, she was very loving, and I have no complaint. But it was not an easy time, and going through the teenage years and already having to deal with such a difficult world, a different world anyway, to try to live up to all of the things that I needed to live up to here in this new society as an outsider, as someone different.
Who was, very hard.
He is American-born, someone who had a difficult childhood also, someone who also became very independent very early on. And I think we both needed each other and found each other to sort of get away from our circumstances. We loved each other. But I think that it was, both of us were very serious and very reasonable people, you know. Practical and very serious people.
Did he understand where you came
yes,
from?
Yes, I think he did. And initially I think that was an appeal to him, an attraction that he could, I suspect that he found it to be a connection, because we both had painful childhoods, so somehow I could connect to him and he could connect to me. And we were married for 17 and a half, almost 18 years.
Children?
We have two children. I have two daughters. I have a daughter who was born when I was 21, and 3 years later another daughter. So I have two wonderful daughters.
What's their names?
Andrea is the oldest, and Karen is the younger. And they are, because I had children so very young, I now have them as my friends, which is very nice.
What was your husband's name?
My first husband's name is Bernard Lewak, L-E-W-A-K. He went on to become a successful CPA, accountant, and became very involved in his work. And as he became more and more involved with his work, I again found myself basically alone and not very, you know, he drew back more and more. And I pretty much fended for myself in many ways. In a sense, I was almost a single parent, because he was really all not that present in many ways. He was always a provider for us. He was a very honest and very good man, but not terribly warm and outwardly affectionate and loving, and that was difficult for me.
So what happened to this marriage?
The marriage broke up. It was ultimately a joint agreement. I mean, we came to it together, but I was the one who finally decided I needed to have more than this. And it was difficult. I was single for almost 9 years, and then connected to someone I had known earlier, someone else, and married again.
What is his name?
His name was, unfortunately, his name was Herman Miller. He died 3.5 months ago, and it's still very raw, very difficult. I think he came closest to being the kind of person that my father was. So I did not marry my father, but I was fortunate to find a man who had some of his attributes. Herman, was a writer, so he was artistic, talented man, very, and a very feeling man, and someone who loved me and allowed me to be who I was and I am, which is a gift. It is hard to find someone who accepts you as you are, and he did. So I'm very fortunate. He was much older than I. He was 19 years older than I. And for the last few years, he had been very sick. He died of a form of dementia, which ultimately is fatal. Dealing with the frontal part of the brain, where the brain actually atrophies, there's not enough blood flow and so on. So he died, not the man that I knew, but even at the end, he was loving and sweet and never complained. And he's someone who I think was connected in some spiritual way to me and also on a greater level. And I had great respect for that. And I consider myself very lucky to have had that in my life. You know, it's strange. I've just spent however long here talking about so many things which are painful, but I talk about them. In this case, I am still in the process of grieving, and so I'm still very raw, and I feel it very, very near still. It's something I cannot still talk about. It is something that I'm still feeling very deeply, this loss. I am missing him a lot. So he accepted me and is someone who was willing to take me with all of my faults, but also appreciated my attributes and my positive aspects. And I don't know of anyone who did not love him and like him. He was a quiet man, but he spoke volumes in his silence. Wonderful.
How about your children?
I have a daughter, Andrea, who is going to be 40 this year, this next year. She is by profession, a therapist, a marriage and family counselor, someone who I think has had difficulty in her life in many ways. And because of the family history, my family history, which I know I have imposed on my children. I know that my children are affected by my past, no question about it. My sense of insecurity sometimes, my sense of protectiveness and all of those things. Anyway, my daughter Andrea is a wonderful person and she's a very good friend.
Married?
No, she's single. And she will always be single because she's someone who has basically is in a lifestyle that does not include men. My daughter Anna Karen is the younger. She will be 36 and she's tomorrow. And she is married to a very fine young man and has two daughters. And my grandchildren are Claire, who is now 7, almost 8, and my granddaughter Leah, who is 4.
Where do they live?
They live in Chicago, and I don't see them very often, but they're with me all the time. You know, I'm not happy about the fact that I'm away from my children. Both of my daughters live away from here. But I understand that they need to live where they live and what they want to do. So I'm accepting of it.
Now, we'll change tapes. We'll talk in a minute. we were talking about
my daughters and granddaughters and my children. My children are, I'm very proud of them. But as I said, I am certain that I have affected them in some very deep way. I know it. We talk of it sometime. And I know that I've affected my grandchildren, I suspect, too. I don't just suspect it. I know it. They also have are carrying this in some way.
How did you, throughout the years, deal with your past?
First of all, because I'm not a camp survivor, I, like many survivors, did not consider myself a survivor because only those who were in camps were considered, often are considered to be survivors. So when we talked about the survivors, we always thought of someone else. We, after all, had it easy, quote unquote. And so it's something that I always sort of, this was what I was told. The other thing is that because I was a child, the assumption was always made by others, and then I bought into this, that my experiences were, after all, very simple and very easy. You were only a child. It didn't affect you. You don't remember anyway, and what you remember is incorrect, and what you remember is of no consequence, really, because the real thing was really like this, and that you had it easy. You didn't suffer. Besides, you were with family, and you were with people who loved you, so why should you, what is this, nothing. That is how it was viewed. And then in 1982, I was contacted by someone here in Los Angeles from Jewish Family Services, Flo Kinsler, as a matter of fact, who became Dr. Flo Kinsler consequently, who called me in and said, you know, I'm doing some groups for survivors, and your name had been given to me by someone as a survivor. Would you like to join these groups? I said, me? I'm not, first of all, I'm not really a survivor. And besides, I've dealt with all of that, and I don't have a problem with it. It's nothing. It's a non-issue. And she said, well, if you ever change your mind, let me know. And soon after, I was invited to attend a meeting, which she and another person, a very important person, by the name of Dr. Sarah Moskowitz, a meeting that was called by Dr. Moskowitz, of people who, like myself, were children during the war, who were invited to come and attend a meeting to find out about an interview project that was being started here in Los Angeles, sponsored by Yale University, the Fortunoff Library at Yale. And she was doing interviews of child survivors because she had just done a book on child survivors. And she wanted to pursue the subject further. Would I be interested, and would we, those of us who were invited, be interested in being interviewed? I said, all right. But while I was at this meeting, she broke us up into smaller groups. And for the very first time in my life, I sat among people who had similar experiences to mine and who issues like mine. And we began to talk. And suddenly a light bulb went on in my, it was as though a revelation, some vision came through. And I recognized the term child survivor. I had never thought of it in those terms. So I, at the end of the meeting, everyone said, okay, we will sign up or not sign up, goodbye and good luck. And I raised my hand and I said, something very special happened for me here. I would like to pursue this further. Is there anyone here who would like to pursue it with me? And about 6-7 people raised their hands. And I said, okay, let's get together. And Dr. Moskowitz said, why don't we get together? I'll sort of facilitate this. And that's how we started. And this was in July or August of 82. We began, and in that way formed the very first child survivor group at that point in existence. At about the same time, other groups began in New York with Dr. Judith Kestenberg, who was also doing work with child survivors. But our group was really the first to really address this issue directly for ourselves, among ourselves. And this group has since gone on to, of course, other groups started, and it is now part of a federation, although not formally, but there's now a federation of child survivors worldwide, and I became very involved in this process. Because the very thing that I told you about initially, about my little friends in Italy, farm children that I played with before the hiding, still holds true. I tend to sort of take charge. And I basically have took charge in a way and have helped to push this through many different stages and periods, ups and downs. And I don't mean to take credit solely, but I think I've been somewhat of a catalyst for some of this group child survivor movement.
What did this involvement do for you personally?
Well, for one thing, it finally opened up. It's like an opening of a door. It's opening up of a window. It's allowing air to come in and then to go out. It's almost like that day in liberation time when I was able to run free. I was allowed to talk about my experiences and recognize and have those experiences acknowledged and recognized and given some validity. And that was very important because I was always this little kid that was in the way. And so here was the first time that I really felt a part of a group that could identify with me and I could identify with. And I felt wonderful, and I still feel wonderful. And when I come together with others who, like myself or children, I really feel a bond. I have made wonderful friendships. And it's like it's an unspoken language. It's like we don't have to tell our stories. It's we know what that all means on a very deep-rooted level.
Did it do anything for you as a Jew?
Yes. I think it brought me back to the recognition of my Jewish identity. I did not become involved religiously, still. By the way, when I came to this country, I attempted to go to temple. When I first came to Los Angeles, I remember the holidays, I went to temple by myself. I walked for miles to get to a temple here in the valley, in the San Fernando Valley. And I got there, and I was asked if I had a ticket. I was so shocked and so amazed that you had to pay to go to a holiday service or any service, that it somehow affected me for the rest of my adulthood in terms of my belonging to, and I have not belonged to a synagogue. I have not been a member of a community in that sense, religiously. My children went to Kinderschule, which was not a religious school, learning Jewish tradition and Jewish stories and about the rituals and the traditions and the holidays and all that. But it was a secular school. It's not a religious school. They didn't particularly love it, but I wanted to have them have some kind of Jewish identity and feelings. I must say that I now have regrets. I wished I had joined the temple and had done more in terms of educating my children and been more active in the Jewish world than I was. But instead, I became active in causes.
I became active. How about your children?
My children are not religiously involved, although my younger daughter now has seen to it that my grandchildren in Chicago are in fact now going to Hebrew schools. My granddaughter is enrolled in a Hebrew school, and it is because it is a fine school. They too do not belong to a synagogue, but they are more observant. Observe Friday night Shabbat lighting. Not every Friday, I don't suspect. They're not that religious about it, but they do, and that's for the children. And somewhere my daughter has learned. I'm very pleased in many ways.
Your involvement in causes, what kind of causes?
My causes tended to always be dealing with the underdog. When my children were old enough, I became a volunteer in many, many places. And I tended to volunteer in places that had to do with people who were victims, people who were hurting. And so I became very active in the civil rights movement. I actually, it was a very major turning point in my life. Becoming involved with the black community, now we call it the Afro-American community, but basically dealing with that aspect of civil rights and the then Chicano community or the Latino community, it was very important to me because I identified in some way with these people who were not being treated equally. And I always was drawn to that, and I became very active, so much so that I actually almost had a full-time career and job doing that and was actually became, you know, a very important volunteer in this community and was given honors and recognized for it by the city in many ways. And then became politically very involved and worked on political campaigns and so on.
So what is your major cause now?
Well, first, before I get to the latest major cause, which is something that has been with me all of my life, I want to point out that another aspect of me has to do with working with aging, which became my profession. I did go back to school and received a special certificate at the University of Southern California from the Andrews Gerontology Center in pre-retirement planning. And after I divorced, I went to work first for a politician, but then on my own in business in the pre-retirement field. And for 20-plus years, I have been in my own consulting business conducting seminars and workshops on how to deal with growing older, because aging is another piece that has always been of interest to me. I've always been with older people, and I have always had respect and some affinity to older people. So as I age, I have accepted my growing older. I am not coloring my hair. I am not doing facelifts. I'm not doing things that a lot of people my age are doing. And that is somewhere because I don't find it offensive or bad. I find that it is, I accept this piece of me, and it's just another phase of my life that I am experiencing, and I think it's pretty wonderful. So that is something that I worked with. So I worked, I had to get a job after divorce and worked with an agency dealing with senior citizens. So aging is another issue that is important to me. But in June of 1994, was invited to attend a meeting that was being held at a studio here in Los Angeles for the purpose of the establishment of a new project, which was sponsored or in some way connected to, I didn't know how, to Steven Spielberg, who was doing a project about survivors. And so I was asked by several people to attend this meeting. And another light bulb went on as a result of this meeting. I learned about the survivors of the Shoah Visual History Foundation, which was the project that Steven Spielberg founded. And the purpose of it, of course, was to establish this archive to record the experiences of those who survived the Holocaust. And clearly, this was something that I wanted to be part of. So I became an interviewer for the foundation initially, and then was asked very shortly thereafter to come to work for the foundation. In doing that, I gave up an income because I was fairly successful in my business. And even though I was paid for what I did initially at the Shoah Foundation, it was very, very minimal. And I thought that I would do this for a time and that I could continue my business on the side. But as time passed, I realized that I couldn't do that, and that I became more and more involved with the foundation's work. And for the past 5 years, have been working very hard, very diligently, very committed in this incredible project that is the Shoah Foundation. And it has brought me closer to my roots. It has brought me closer to that part of me that is so important to me. And it has also provided me with an opportunity to not be a passive victim, but to do something in a very active and proactive way to counter that piece that was the victim. So I'm doing something to fight back by being part of this foundation. And so I'm very verbal about it. I speak about it. I speak of it. I represent it in many places. And I, in my way, have basically made myself a part of that foundation on various levels. I'm very proud of what I've been part of and continue to be part of and hope to stay with it as long as possible. It's something that I feel, it's almost like a coming full circle, having done something to make me more whole in some way. Very important to me. Very important. It also, by the way, gave me the opportunity to see to it that my rescuer the only person who's still alive, basically, of the family who rescued me, of one of the families who rescued me, to be interviewed as well, which has been a wonderful experience. And that woman's name is Giulia Guidotti, who was interviewed a year and a half ago by the foundation in Italy. And I think that's you know, a very special piece that the rescuer and now me being interviewed by the foundation is sort of a nice coming together.
As a child survivor, what is your message to future generations, especially to young people?
I usually talk to young people, and I do that, have done that, and continue to do that whenever I can, because I find that very rewarding, by the way, and very important. One of the things that I really try to convey and impart is the fact that this is something that can happen to anyone. I mean, it is. We were not even the only thing that set us apart was the fact that we were Jews. It had to do with our beliefs and our history as Jews. But that we were an average family living in an average city with average lives, and we were caught up in this horror. And that this is something that can happen, and that we complacency and taking things for granted must never be. That we need to be vigilant and very conscious of injustices and intolerance whenever we come across it. So my message is that we cannot let even small things go by and let them go unchecked. That we need to really be very conscious of every small thing, because those very small things build into larger things, which then become out of control. And that each of us has a role to play in this. It isn't the other guy. Each one of us has a responsibility and a role to play in this, from at any age, at every level, in every community. Because unfortunately, we as human beings are capable of this. And I am not free of prejudice. I know my prejudices. I know where I stand as well, and I am not free of them. I recognize them. I think that's number one. I think one has to be able to recognize and admit to them, and then hopefully not to act on them, but to go beyond. And that we each have that responsibility. The other thing I like to also mention is that I also recognized how resilient we are as human beings, and how we're capable of doing and surviving and living through many more things than we assume we can. That we are much tougher and much stronger than we all think we are. And it's not some special gift that we have. It is also part of the human condition and part of the human quality. So as we have the dark side, there is also this other side which sees us through these difficult times. And so I think I want people to also, and young people, to recognize that aspect of themselves, and that they are also capable of that. So that is the plus and the minus, or the minus and the plus in it. I think there is hope. I have not given up hope. I wouldn't be here if it weren't for that. I think honesty is utmost. It's very important. I think we need to be very honest with ourselves first, and with each other. And I think we need to consider one another as best possible. But honesty, I think, is very key. And the recognition that we are all part of this. It isn't just us and them. We're all part of this together.
Is there any question you would like me to ask you?
You've just asked it. I don't know. I think, Renee, you have done a very fine job of reaching into me and drawing out those things that I recall. I guess perhaps the only thing is, what is the difference between being a child survivor and a survivor? Maybe that's the question. You know, what sets me apart? That would be the only thing that I would perhaps pose if I were you. And I would answer it by saying that all of us have been children. That is something that we all have in common, no matter where or who. And that it is really important that we sometimes go back to our own experiences as a child to be able to relate and recognize in others what they may be experiencing. I, as a child, have experiences that are those of the older ones, older survivors that lived through that time with me. But from the perspective of a small child, of someone who had no knowledge of really, of intellectual knowledge of what was going on, I go on feelings. I think that it is important to recognize that that piece of it, that part of it, which we all can dig back into ourselves, is very important in how we become, are formed as human beings.
Thank you.
Thank you. This is the yellow star that was worn by my mother and kept all of these years, and I now have it.
What does it say in the middle?
Jude.
Which means?
Jew.
Thank you.
I think, I don't know.
Who are these people?
This is a portrait of my grandmother, great-grandmother, and great-great-grandmother, I believe, and even great-great-grandmother beyond that.
Who is this person with a parasol?
The woman with a parasol is my grandmother as a young girl in Vienna. Her name was Elsa Kohn.
Her last name? Her maiden name?
That was her maiden name, and her married name was Elsa Korichan. This is my great-grandmother. I'm sorry, I don't know her name. And this was her mother, I believe. So it's my great-great-great-grandmother also. I'm afraid I don't know a name. This is Grete Kohn, my grandmother's sister, who then became Grete Weiner. W-E-I-N-E-R, I believe.
Where was this picture taken?
It must have been taken in Vienna.
Do you know when?
It probably was in the mid or late 1800s.
Thank you.
These are my maternal parents, so my grandparents, again, Elsa Kohn Korichan and Alfred Korichan.
Where was this picture?
I suspect this was taken near Zagreb or in Zagreb.
When?
It looks like, the turn of the century, end of the 18th century, perhaps.
Thank you.
The 19th century, excuse me.
Thank you.
These are my mother's siblings, part of the siblings. On the bottom on the left is my mother, Lily, at that time Korichan. Above her is Irene Korichan, a sister. On the very far right is my mother's twin sister, Gertrude or Trude Korichan. And in the middle, Hans and Leopold, two boys.
Where was this picture taken?
This was probably taken also near Zagreb in Krapinska Toplica.
When?
I guess my mother was born in 1903, so this must have been around 1910. This picture was taken in 1939. I believe it was in Cerkvenica, just before and during this, all the various attempts of escape. My father on the right, Georg Hirsch. My mother, Lily Korichan Hirsch. Her sister, Gertrude Korichan Barsoni. My uncle, Egon Barsoni, her husband, myself as a one-year-old or a little less, my grandmother, Elsa Korichan, my aunt Irene Hirsch, also married to a Hirsch, my father's brother. This man, Walter Hirsch. My cousin Susie Barsoni. My cousin Ernest Hirsch. My sister Inge Hirsch. And my cousin Liselotte, or Lilo, Barsoni. This was the last time, I think, that we all had smiles on our faces.
What country was it in?
This was in Yugoslavia.
Thank you.
This is my sister Inge Hirsch. And me, Daisy Miller. Probably age 6 to 9 months.
Where and when?
Yugoslavia, Zagreb.
When?
1939.
Thank you.
As okay. to where either.
So probably. Just say it.
This is my father, Georg Hirsch, and my mother, Lily Hirsch. I am not certain as to the date or the place.
Your mother's maiden name?
My mother's maiden name was Korichan.
Thank you.
This is my family in Quarata, probably in 1942, so not long before we had to run away.
What country?
In Italy. This is my sister Inge, my father Georg, my mother Lily, and myself, Daisy.
Last names?
Mine is, at the time we were all Hirsch, mine is now Miller. My sister is Servi.
Do you know when?
This was probably 1942, and it was in the garden of that house where we were all assembled in hide before we went into deep hiding in the villa.
Thank you.
This is a picture of my mother and my two daughters. On the left is my daughter Karen Liwak, my daughter on the right, Andrea Liwak, and my mother, Lily Hirsch Cowders. Cowders was her second married name. My mother died in 1994.
When was this picture taken?
This picture was probably taken in 92 or 93, not long
Where?
Before she died. Here in Los Angeles, in my home.
Thank you.
Picture of my daughter Karen in the middle, Karen Liwak, her husband, Dr. Craig Niederberger, my granddaughter Leah, and my granddaughter Claire.
Their last name?
Their last name is Niederberger. My daughter still uses Liwak.
And when was this picture?
This was probably taken about a year and a half or 2 years ago, and so I would say in 1997.
Where?
In Chicago.
Thank you.
This is a photograph of myself, Daisy Miller, with my husband, Herman Miller. This was probably taken in around 1981 or two.
Where?
Here in Los Angeles.
What occasion?
At, I believe, my 25-year high school reunion.
Thank you.
Great. And this is an addendum to the interview with Daisy Miller, interviewer Renee Firestone, in Studio City, California, United States, and the language is English. And an addendum to my interview conducted a few days ago. And I have asked to add this information because I feel that what I have suffered from and what I am affected by for the rest of my life is directly as a result of what happened during the war. And I specifically am talking about my having been diagnosed with breast cancer at the age of 43, which is quite young to have, in fact, been diagnosed with this kind of a disease. A rather, although more common, certainly more unusual, and something that I would never have expected because there was really no history in my family of breast cancer. I am convinced, as I think my doctors have agreed, that it is a likelihood that I have had to deal with breast cancer because of the fluoroscopy and the large number of x-rays that I had to have as a child right after the war. When I had pleurisy right after the war and weekly was under the fluoroscopy screen and so much x-ray bombarded at me, I was also told that for the rest of my life I would have to be x-rayed every single year. I think that that is clearly as a direct result of what happened during the war, and I attribute it then as another piece to that Holocaust history. At a young age, in my early 50s, I was also diagnosed with osteoporosis, which is a disease of the weakness of the bones and brittleness of the bones, and that's something that is clearly something also, I'm sure, affected by the lack of milk products, nutrition, and calcium in my childhood. I think that I will have to live forever, and hopefully my life will be a long life, although I don't know. But I will always have to live with the consequences of that past. And the fact that others, like myself, who were children, are still to this day affected on a daily basis by the very issues that are so clearly connected to that history. So many of us are suffering from early onset of diseases which would normally come much later in life. And I think that this is something that needs to be recognized and stated. We, those of us who were children, that population that had been so overlooked for so long, are now, I think perhaps, going to be serving, and hopefully serving in a positive way, as resources and as models for study as to how this kind of deprivation and the kinds of results of trauma, such as the one that we had, might in fact be helpful towards helping other children of the future. I am clearly an advocate and someone who speaks out for those of us who are children. I have made that very clear, and I plan to continue to do so. I just wanted to make sure that this is an aspect of our experience that would be recorded as well. So I have wanted to add this piece to my testimony, and in the hopes that it will be of use and service to future generations. Thank you.